The reason why I consider you to be one of the most epic benchmarks in Indian social media is because you've done it in Hindi, you've done it in English, you've done it with short form, you've done it with long form.
My name is Ranveer Allahbadia.
We know him as BeerBiceps.
What if all your life that you've experienced comes crashing down?
I'll rebuild it.
This is perhaps the question that's going to come from a million other people. Why do you talk about tantric, yeti, and also sex?
Oh man, I can't. This is the first time talking about this.
If you were a brand, how would you approach social media campaigns? Where would you choose YouTubers? Where would you choose Instagram?
So, like, I know that my main game is masses.
But doesn't that make you feel like you're losing your identity? I have tried to crack Instagram multiple times, but it has not happened. But you've done it on Instagram not once, but thrice.
Like, I'm trying to get into content that's inspired by thinkschool.
Talk to me about the machine gun strategy.
Okay, wow. I thought that's a top secret.
How did you get Tanmay as a client? But why do you think YouTube creators command such a high premium when it comes to brand deals as well as audience loyalty? Is it simply because of the content that they put out?
Like, I think some of these orange juice gang, they're going to be media legends in 20 years, 30 years time.
Does that sum up our conversation?
I feel a little naked right now.
Hi everybody, this is a conversation that I had with Ranveer Allahbadia, also known as BeerBiceps. While most people see Ranveer as just another content creator, what they don't realize is that Ranveer is the king of Indian social media. And I say this because there is nobody in this entire country who has been able to crack YouTube and Instagram both in Hindi and in English. And he knows every single social media platform so well that today, he has 7 million subscribers on his English YouTube channel, 8 million subscribers in his Hindi YouTube channel, almost 2 million on both of his clips channel, and on Instagram, he has 2.4 million followers in his Hindi account and 4 million in his English account. Along with this, there is also a TRS account which also has another million followers, and that too, it has grown in the past 60 days itself. And same is the case with his Twitter and LinkedIn account. As a result, today, BeerBiceps is a multi-million dollar media company with a distribution of 22 million subscribers. Now, to most people, Ranveer is a creator, but to me, he has been a kind teacher, brother, and an inspiration. So I got to ask him all the sneaky questions just like a little brother, which resulted into a 2-hour masterclass on how to build a million-dollar business using social media, how to play the algorithms of YouTube and Instagram and use them to catapult your following, how should brands approach social media marketing, and most importantly, what are the biggest mistakes that creators and brands make which fail them in the Indian social media space. And people, while we are at the subject of building a million-dollar business, nobody taught me or Ranveer how to build a business. But you can learn how to become a brilliant business leader with Scalar School of Business. The best part is that they have scholarships up to 100% if you register using the link below. People, India's education system is so messed up that even after studying for 4 years, 35% of our engineers and 30% of our MBA grads are unemployable. But here's where Scalar School of Business is revolutionizing business education in India. They are offering a full-time 18-month PG program in management and technology. And this program is so amazing that it is built and taught by industry leaders who have scaled billion-dollar companies like Uber, Myntra, and McKinsey. And to help you thrive in this hyper-competitive market, as a part of the Scalar curriculum itself, you will work on real-world projects, you will build your own business, you will take it to the market, generate revenue, and also raise VC capital while studying on campus. And since Scalar has been in the education industry for 7 long years, they already have access to 1,200 plus company partners, which includes Google, Amazon, Flipkart, and more. And this is something that no other business school can offer in India right now. In fact, their online programs have been so successful that their placement rates have touched 96% and their median CTC stands at 25 lakh rupees. And now, Scalar School of Business is handpicking only 75 students for their founding cohort starting early September 2024. The best part is that they have scholarships up to 100% if you register using the link below. So if you want to become a brilliant business leader, apply for Scalar School of Business using the link in my description and in my comment section. And now, on with the episode. So what I find extremely fascinating about you is your story. And not a lot of people know your story, because back then you used to talk a lot about your story, but now you don't. And I just asked a few people about whether they know how Ranveer became Ranveer. They don't know much about it. And I remember that back then you were extremely aggressive, like you were a rebel.
Yeah.
And I remember that Quint, I think, they published your video on you speaking something about Amir Khan and his transformation. I remember all of that. And, you know, one day I was sitting right after college, I was sitting at a cafe and I was telling Teju, and during that time, I think you had hit a milestone of 3 million subscribers. And until that point, you had posted, the caption said, after 400 videos, we are finally here at 3 million subscribers. So that's when I told her that the day I hit 400 videos is the day I can expect to have 3 million subscribers. Until then, I'm going to put my head down and I'm going to keep on working. So I divided 400 by 3. I said, you know, roughly 130, 140 videos. 130, 140 good videos, great videos is what you need to get to 1 million subscribers. So I said, let's put in the work. Let's get to 140 videos and let's see where it goes. So I have seen your entire journey, but not a lot of people know that. And you know, a lot of people only see you as a podcaster. But I was just telling the guys over here that Ranveer is the king of Indian social media for multiple reasons. A, because you've done it in Hindi, in English, which is extremely difficult. I have just started my Hindi channel. I understand how difficult it is, because we both are comfortable in English. In Hindi, it is extremely uncomfortable. And then I again went back to your old Hindi videos to see how your Hindi was back then. And it was terrible, bro.
Yeah.
I was like, if Ranveer can do this, so can I. Because I speak like Rohit Sharma, bro, in Hindi. Okay, and there's a lot of slang here and there. So I said, dude, if I speak like this, people are going to understand that I am not the guy they think I am.
We're Maharashtra boys, bro.
Yeah.
Like, there is that little Maratha angle mixed in our Hindi.
Yeah, so I thought, ye toh bahut hi tapori lagega agar main aisa baat karunga toh. But let me just go back to see what Ranveer did. And then I saw your videos and I can clearly see that you're struggling to, you know, speak. And you're thinking, and then you're just thinking about just saying something. And I said, you know, let's start our Hindi channel. And that's how we started. So the reason why I consider you to be one of the most epic benchmarks in Indian social media is because you've done it in Hindi, you've done it in English, you've done it with short form, you've done it with long form. I just saw your Instagram engagement and I was telling the guys also about it. 10 million views, 4 million views, 3 million views. It is not a joke. And I have tried to crack Instagram multiple times, but it has not happened. But you've done it on Instagram not once, but thrice. With Ranveer Allahbadia, with Beer Biceps, they have two different pieces of contents going out every single day, along with TRS, which by itself is another channel. Even that is about to hit a million. So bro, my agenda for today's podcast is to go deep inside that social media, I wouldn't say hacker, but I would say I want to understand that social media legend within you, to try and see how did you go from being a random kid distributing pamphlets at the beach to now having cumulatively what, 20 odd million followers across social media platforms. And what I also want to uncover is the reason behind the consistency of how you post and how many views and how much engagement you get. Because a lot of people often get stuck between this dilemma of either posting great content or posting high engagement content. But somehow you've been able to strike the balance in such a way, or some people get stuck with the dilemma of posting too much content or too less. Okay, I'm the guy who posts too less. So I'm always concerned about, you know, if I just put in a lot of videos, then if I push out a lot of videos, the quality might go down. So that is the second agenda that I want to uncover today, which is the understanding of how do you strike a perfect balance between consistency and volumes, and how do you scale this entire thing in such a way that you go on to become an entrepreneur and not just remain as a social media content creator. And this is what I keep telling all my friends, okay? And this is also something that I've learned from you, that if you're a creator, you will last for 4 years. If you are an entrepreneur, you will last for a decade. Okay, so those are the things that I want to uncover. So let's start with your story. 2015, Ranveer is this dude who just hit the gym, got a great body, and posted this first video. Hi guys, my name is Ranveer Allahbadia, I'm a fitness trainer, and you started giving out tips, and you're just sitting like that with a sleeveless yeah. T-shirt, right?
Nike. I still have that compression T-shirt.
Yeah. So talk to me about that phase of 2015. What got you started with YouTube, even when YouTube was not cool, even before the Jio wave?
Okay. First, a question for you. Am I more fun than Nirmala Sitaraman to sit okay. in front of?
I know that, bro.
Okay, hold on. Okay, it's hard to have a work conversation with you on some degree because I play football with you, so we have that equation. So I'm going to try keeping jokes apart, okay, because we're on thinkschool right
it's
now.
Okay, bro. You can crack jokes.
We can go all out. Also, if I go on a rant, stop me and then, like, you know, make me talk specifics. Your question was about 2015. 2015, let's go to 2014, which is my final year of engineering college. Consciously didn't sit for any of the engineering college placements because they were all coding related jobs. And that was the one thing I could never wrap my head around. It was just not a skill that came naturally to me, while I have respect for coders. So I knew that, okay, I'm not going to do this. And I'd done internships in engineering college. So I had a kind of raw gaze that, dude, my own skill set is great for business. I'm a great communicator. I have business acumen. And now I have to just figure which domain I'll like get into. So the game plan was always to do my own thing, but didn't learn how to formally, like, you know, start a startup. Didn't know how to go about it either. So when I graduated, I told my parents that give me a month, take care of me for a month, financially, etc. And I'll figure out what I should do after that. 2 weeks into that break, I was thinking, I was just figuring out what to do next. I called up a relative of mine who owned an engineering factory. Okay. Told him that I'll work with you for free. I'll just shadow you. Take me everywhere. Worked in that factory for a month. Okay. And I figured that business is not that complicated. They were running a company that made chemical agitators, which are like chemical mixers, which is a very engineering specific business. But I asked each department to break down their job and I realized, oh, it's all systems and processes. Mm-hmm. There's actually nothing difficult here. Because in the workshop, I would see like a guy who's not done engineering. He was probably a 10th pass. You know, couldn't speak English. But was able to help construct those chemical agitators. That taught me that, dude, a lot about life and business is based on self-learning and interest. I had a Masi who worked in that factory. And she kind of figured out what I was all about. She understood that I'm trying to launch my own career. It was probably maybe max 2 to 4 weeks that I spent in that factory, learned a lot about the world. And parallelly, I finished that 1 month I took from my parents. So my dad sat me down and he told me that you need to now kind of go independent. So people have this impression that I'm from a rich family. Okay, my parents had made a lot of money between my 5th grade and my 10th grade. And then there was a massive financial problem and we kind of lost almost everything that we had financially, other than the roof overhead. And my parents are doctors. So doctors always have work. So my parents were in the rebuilding phase themselves and they couldn't afford to just say, dude, you know, do what you want and we'll pay for you. And both my parents are very type A personalities. So they both wanted me to ukhado something in life or at least, you know, be on my own 2 feet. So my dad sat me down and he said, either you start studying for an MBA right now or start studying for your next steps or you take up a job. And if you're not going to do one of these, then I'll stop paying for your food and, you know, all the ways that a parent supports you other than letting you stay in my house.
He'll stop paying for food also, he said.
Yeah, everything.
Damn.
And that's probably the best thing my father's done for me. And I've had a strained relationship with my father all my life. But I look back at that one moment as probably the best thing that my father did for me. And we're at peace now. And he knows on some level, I think I'm very grateful to him for that one moment now. Because I think that that's the role of a father. You need to give that tough love situation. So anyway, he was on his own journey of rebuilding his own career. I was in this place where it was kind of like back to the wall. You know, like I call it balls against the wall. Very afraid about the world, but also ready to go at it. In engineering college, I'd done a fitness certification course just out of interest. So I was technically a certified trainer. So the day that this incident happened with my dad, I think it was almost like the next day, I'd gone to my engineering office, but I decided, you know what, let me go to Carter Road and just figure out trying to sell myself as a fitness trainer to people. So I did exactly that. I wore like tighter t-shirts and shorts, went out, found some guys who were slightly overweight, spoke to them, broed out a little bit. I said that I'm a fitness trainer. I'll be able to train you. And because I was able to speak in English, you automatically earn a premium there. So I locked one of my first clients. Now that Masi at the engineering factory, she made me sit down and she's like, okay, this is a nice kind of small revenue stream that you've built. How about looking at this at scale? So I envisaged an Uber for fitness trainers where one can sit at home and just click on a button and order workout. Sort of like what Urban Company is doing today. I sat and drew out a UI UX without having any knowledge of UI UX just for fun. And I realized I had something there. So I started watching a Stanford online course, which is free of course. It's called How to Start a Startup. I think it's run by Y Combinator. And I understood how startups work because of that. So I realized at that point that you need to raise money for this. Found an angel investor somewhere, reached out to him. He was someone who worked at Crizzle. I have not met that guy, like, you know, in a very long time now. But that one meeting was very important for me because he told me that, you know, a lot of people are trying to do this Uber for fitness trainers concept. How you'd be able to break out is you look good, you can talk well, consider social media. So I literally started BeerBiceps the next day. One of my closest friends in life, his name's Aditya Valvi. I told him the idea and he pulled out an image of a beer glass from somewhere. He pulled out those arms from somewhere. He's like, take. Use this as your logo. And eventually I got that logo trademarked and all that. But it was actually designed by him. I literally, that video of me sitting on that sofa is recorded 1 or 2 days after this meeting with the Crizzle guy. So it was just very quick execution with the vision of building an Uber for trainers. But as I kept putting out videos and I kept training people, I was making a lot of money in cash from the training. Pumping it back into my YouTube stuff. Found Rajas Pardeshi, who was my first teammate. He would record videos for me. So over the course of 1 year, I also started training Tanmay from AIB.
Okay. How did you get Tanmay as a client?
Just reached out to him. Once I got very drunk one night when I was 22. I don't drink anymore. But I got like smashed one night. And I think my whole DNA at that point was just keep growing. Figure out a way to grow. So I wrote out a very emotional piece to Tanmay saying that I'm a huge AIB fan and I understand what you go through in terms of people trolling you for your weight. Give me a chance. You know, I can do something with you.
Wow.
So like he agreed. He's like, okay, come meet me at XYZ location. And I took that as the biggest opportunity of my life. So I went and met him. He's like, can you find me a gym? I would just go into random gyms in Andheri and say, I'll get you a top content creator. Let me start training him from tomorrow. Eventually, we figured out, you know, how to train together. I would be at his house and he was cool enough to let me spend an hour extra post the session or pre the session. And we'd do a lot of shit talking, like it's Tanmay.
Okay.
But he'd also brief me a lot on how his career was going about. And this is like 2015, 2016, where influencer marketing is not a thing. So he would tell me that, can you imagine a reality where a cycle brand pays you 1 lakh rupees just to talk about them on Snapchat? And I said that, bro, it's a great thought. It's happening in America, but will it truly happen in India? And I was earning a lot of money in cash again from fitness training. But once I saw him starting to crack his few deals, I kind of realized that, hold on, my YouTube channel is also growing. I had to have a little bit of a painful conversation with him about needing to stop training him like as a fitness trainer. I don't think he had liked it at the time, but then I've been bros with him for so long now that I think he's probably even forgotten about this. Like, and he's been that big brother figure, like, you know, throughout my career in many ways. And fortunately, then there have been a lot of others as well. I think my whole career is an outcome of really smart people coming together and guiding me correctly at like the right point in time. But at that point, it was all Tanmay. And then parallelly, we just staying consistent with our uploads. Like, I remember it was Tuesday and Friday without fail. Like, no matter what happens, a video has to release on Tuesday, a video has to release on Friday. I actually have a story here. Again, so I'm an engineering grad, okay? And you don't really understand that dressing is important, grooming is important, all that. Parallelly, we were doing fitness content. So I used to experiment the fitness content on my own body, understand what's happening, and then put it out for the world. It was just a standard practice I followed. So that time, ketogenic diets were a massive wave, and it had given me a lot of growth. And I got known as the keto guy, though I'm not, I hate that concept. I hate that style of eating. I think it's unhealthy for your body. It's unhealthy for your mind. But at that point, I was experimental. I was 22, 23 years old. So I ended up going on zero carbs. I would eat like red meat every single day, maybe in every meal. No veggies almost, you know, like one bowl of veggies. Got ripped as shit, okay, but my skin and hair went for a toss. Okay. Lots of hair fall, lots of skin trouble. Okay. So my sister and mom made me sit down one day and they were like, listen, you're an on-screen, you're a media guy now. And we're sitting at what, like 20,000 subscribers, 30,000 subscribers. But they started giving me shit about my skin and hair, like your grooming, like, you know, that you need to take care of this. Everything's gone for a toss. That was the first time I felt conscious about being in media. But we had to release videos every Tuesday and Friday. So I remember this one particular phase where I think I broke out too much and my hair fall had increased too much. And I was very conscious about my own self-image. But we had to release a video. So I ended up calling a friend of mine, going to Five Gardens, which is a park near my house. And, you know, shooting a motivational video of me shirtless from really far. So you can't see my face, but you can see my body from really far. Figuring out, you know, getting Tanmay in that video, getting a clip of him working out as well, and turned it into a motivational video. You know, and crying, feeling conscious and all, but not missing that upload date. And that was so important back then, because that kind of a psychological struggle really toughens you up for the journey to come. So we've reached a point now where if you count short content, we're probably releasing something like 300 pieces a week. So, but that is happening because there were certain systems and processes and self-discipline in place at that phase, irrespective of my mental health, irrespective of where I am emotionally. You keep going because in this game, consistency matters and consistency compounds a lot. But I think that that early phase where you're just, all of us are not trained media professionals. None of us have done, you know, courses in this. Until now, like now people do courses, thanks to people like us. But at that point, you're learning about media. How does one dress? How does one speak? How does one look in front of camera? So can be very psychologically challenging. And that's what I think a lot of new creators go through as well. They get overly conscious about trolls, overly conscious about how they look. This can be a severe psychological roadblock if you're looking at this as a 10, 15 year career. Sorry, we went on this tangent, but...
But this is I'm drawing out a lot of lessons from here, bro. So what I draw out from here is that, by the way, Tuesday, Friday, you know why we upload on Tuesday and Friday? Because also you upload on Tuesday and Friday. So me and Pash, I still remember this conversation. We were sitting down and I told him, ki bhai, Tuesday, Friday ko video release karenge. So he was like, dude, you're so particular about everything. Why did you pick Tuesday and Friday? I was like, kuch nahi bro, Ranveer is doing it on Tuesday and Friday. He must have thought something. So let's just do Tuesday and Friday. And bro, the same thing that you underwent, which is not missing an upload no matter what. That is exactly what even I went through. But during that time, Parsh was like, dude. So by the way, when we started growing very fast, I thought there is something wrong with the YouTube algorithm. Because nobody can grow so fast. Okay, bro, we were hitting 100,000 subscribers a month. Okay, and everybody is just calling me and asking me, dude, how are you doing it? I was like, dude, I don't know. So I had this, I don't know whether it's a trauma or that's just OCD. I somehow thought that because of my consistent upload of Tuesday and Friday, I'm getting growth.
You know, you are the last YouTuber that I know who I consider a YouTuber.
Okay.
I've not seen people from your generation grow their YouTube channel. There's that girl who does geography now. She's another one.
Okay.
Out of the content pieces that have reached me, being a YouTuber was so much more appreciated in 2016-17. I think lots of people don't play this game now, but this is the one and only game for long-term content creation for me. You know, creating horizontal long-form content. Can you grip that audience for that amount of time in today's day and age where attention spans are even lower?
And also to be at it for a very long time. Because bro, the point is whenever there was a Friday upload, so Friday uploads used to be extremely stressful because Tuesday ke baad you had only, Tuesday ke baad you had Wednesday, Thursday, and then you had Friday. But after Friday, you had Saturday, Sunday, Monday. You had 3 days during that time. So Thursday night, I still remember, there was a video that we put out on Airbnb and I had just got my COVID shot and I was like, somebody told me that within 2 hours, you're going to get sick. So you just have 2 hours. Bro, after getting the shot, I immediately came back home. I said, let's start shooting. And in the middle of the shoot, I started to fall sick. And I could literally see my eyes going red because during that time I was shooting with a selfie camera from my OnePlus 7 phone on an Amazon basic tripod, jisme maine MC lagaya tha because the tripod was not very functional. That is when I realized that shit, I'm falling sick, so I'm going to miss my upload tomorrow. Bro, I tried to sleep, couldn't sleep because it was stressing me out. After a certain point, I had to sleep. Woke up in the morning, 4 a.m., started the light, and there was no light during that time, so I got in a ring light, tried to shoot with it, again failed. 7 a.m. attempted again, failed. 10 a.m. attempted again. During that time I was feeling good. Suddenly the fever had just gone away. So then I started shooting. I was just sweating like crazy. Okay, so then I had to take a break because there was no AC in the house, and because of my light color shirt, my sweat was visible. So again I had to take a break, again started shooting at 11 a.m. Finally we finished shooting at 12. And the upload was supposed to happen at 9 p.m. So 12 to 9 at it. During that time, I had just taken up a Skillshare course on editing. So 9 hours, I was just completely focused and obsessed with just uploading that video at 9 p.m. 8:30, the video got uploaded. 9 p.m. premiere. After that premiere was done, I watched the entire premiere from 9 p.m. to 9:15. Bro, after 9:15, I just crashed. And during that time, my mom, my dad, everybody was like, dude, are you crazy? Like, what is this shit? Like, it is YouTube. It's not going away anywhere. Parsh was like, dude, you got to take it easy. This is not how you're going to build a sustainable career. This is not worth it. Like, no. Every Tuesday, every Friday, video to jayega hi. And now we're at a position where we don't focus on Tuesday and Friday, but still that banner is still there. Business case studies every Tuesday and Friday. And the reason why I do not focus on upload schedule right now is because now I'm like, dude, let's focus on quality more. Because more than the upload schedule, it is important that you give people more value. So it's okay if you take another day, but if you can give them a better experience with sound, or if you can add a few things extra, there's no hassle with that. So let's focus on the quality of the content. Bro, that obsession. And after you reach a certain point, when you look back at that phase where you were like grinding, bro, that is when you feel that gratification of where you've come and what you've become, right? And right now you're sitting at 7, 8 million subscribers and you're putting out 300 pieces of content. But back then you were an artist. And from the heart, you were an artist, right? And with all these insecurities, when you go on to build something, a lot of people don't understand. There's a lot of blood and sweat, literally blood and sweat that has gone into producing what we produce. And that is crazy, bro. Again, I draw so much inspiration from all of these things.
Same, bro. You're one of the people that I turn to learn from at this stage, because I feel like
really?
in content creation, that learning phase never gets done and you need other players to learn from. Okay. Again, football.
What do you learn, bro?
For example, when you increase the length of your videos, you're able to still retain the audience. Yeah. So even if you want to talk extremely deep, extremely niche stuff, I think you were the first guy in India like to do it. So it kind of gives the other content creators that direction that, okay, this is also possible. That then just generally, I think you're way sharper at like business. Like if I want business advice for my own shit, you're one of the first guys I'll call. Plus you're not in my ecosystem, which is a very important aspect, because no matter how wide-eyed you are, no matter how much perspective one has, people's ecosystems eventually become echo chambers when it comes to growth. So you have to turn to someone on the outside. I learned this from Captain Raghu Raman, who was your boss, I think, at one point. He told me to always get external perspective, and that's been a game changer. So you, Agastya Shah, another guy I really look up to. I think people are not ready for what Agastya Shah will do in the industry. And I say that because there's a certain DNA in some people where they just built for content creation in the long term. And in one word, I'd call that intensity. I think a certain level of intensity is needed in one's personality to go forward in this career and build business and build other revenue streams out of content creation. Back to football, there's different formations in football. Okay, and when I was growing up, a lot of football teams would build their whole team around one player. Okay. So there used to be this guy called Ibrahimovic, who's, you know, Zlatan right now. If Zlatan was in your team and you wanted to get the best out of the team, you build the whole team around him. Okay. Everyone has to either pass him the ball, or even the other players have to be selected based on Zlatan. I truly believe that content creation is a very Zlatan Ibrahimovic game. But that also means there's a lot of pressure on Zlatan. He has to deliver, he has to up the quality of himself, and he elevates the whole team. Here, we know it's a team sport, content creation. You will scale with people around you, but they will all turn to you for energy and intensity. So that shouldn't go down over time, which brings me back to that original thing we were talking about, physical fitness. Like, a content creator has to be physically fit in the long term. Truly believe that.
You know, you mentioned football, and here's where I could think of Michael Jordan and Last Dance. You've seen that documentary, right?
Yeah.
And in that documentary, once, before Phil Jackson, everything was centered around Michael Jordan. And when Phil Jackson came in, he asked, what's the game plan? And everybody told him that Michael Jordan has to be given the ball so that he can go and score. Bro, that's when Phil Jackson told Michael Jordan, he said, until you think of yourself as the best player in the world, you will be the best player in the world, but we'll be the worst team in the world. To be able to think of yourself as the best player in the world should not come at the cost of undermining other people in the team. So you have a choice whether you want to build the best team in the world or you want to become the best player in the world. The beauty is, if you build the best team in the world, people will always turn to you to try and see if you are the best player in the world. And that's where you have the winning advantage. So that's when they got in Scotty. That's when they got in Dennis Rodman. And eventually they built a team which is now known as one of the greatest, if not the greatest team basketball has ever seen. And after that, Chicago Bulls never won the kind of championships they did, right? And Michael Jordan also, when he was, I think, 19 or 20, there's this famous interview whereby he said that, the only thing that I'm expecting to achieve by the time I retire is that we go on to become champions at least once. And then Michael Jordan's last dance wala jo speech hai, over there, he says that, you know, when Chicago Bulls drafted Michael Jordan, I said that by the time I leave, we will be champions. Today, we are 5-time champions going for the 6th. Thank you so much. Bro, what a moment, right? Yeah. And that is what I took back from that entire series, that if you consider yourself, and over here, it's very easy to get carried away, right? Because you are there in front of the camera. Everybody's appreciating you. Oh, Ranveer, you know, you're doing such a good job. Oh, Ganesh, you're doing such a good job. But nobody really recognizes our Scottie Pippens and Dennis Rodman. Even today, who recognizes Scottie Pippen and Dennis Rodman, right? But what is extremely important, and this is again something that I've learned from you, that is, if you want to become an entrepreneur, you need to have the right guys beside you. Like, you had Viraj, you had Rajas, I have Parsh. And fundamentally, what I was always focusing on is that, and I still remember this phone call with Parsh, I was like, dude, Ranveer has too many people. Like, we just have each other. We need more core members. And that's where we got in Rahul. Again, nobody knows about Rahul, but he's the one who runs performance ads for us. And we are getting the best return on investment ever through our performance marketing through Rahul. And he's the one who actually tells us how should we market our course. And once we started to build this core team, just like a football team or a basketball team, we realized that I don't have to do a lot of work. I just have to focus on the core work. And when everything else is standing as a pillar in the organization, that is when the organization by itself functions with utmost efficiency as well as consistency. And more importantly, with efficiency and consistency, the quality doesn't drip. Because when it comes to something like content, it's very easy to get carried away and lower the content quality in the race of increasing volumes and in the race of becoming consistent. And now when I think back, 2 to 3 years later, I was thinking of myself as Michael Jordan. I thought I'm going to be the best content creator in the country. But now I say that I have to be the best organization in content creation so that we can build something at scale for a longer term without compromising on the happiness or the fitness of the individuals who are in this process. And more importantly, as we keep on growing, the growth of the quality of the content or the channel should not come because of the effort put in by me. It has to come in because of the efforts put in by the pillars in the organization. And that is how, by the way, bro, you mentioned 300 pieces of content a week, right? This is again something that I've taken so many inspirations from you, bro. I can just go on and on about it. 1.5 years back, a lot of these agencies told me, agency friends told me that, bro, why aren't you doing Instagram? I said, I just checked out Ranveer's Instagram and I saw that he's doing podcast and that is scaling up very well. So that's very less effort. But at the same time, you can at least focus on that 1 hour of content and then you can deliver high quality content at scale. So until we start our podcast, I'm not going to focus on Instagram at all. So I left it, bro. Okay, we were at 300K odd. We left it. Then we started our podcast and then I said, now let's start putting out content. This is 18 months later. Okay, 18 months later, when we started posting on Instagram, bro, with a single podcast, we started posting 7 shorts, 7 reels. That also got turned into a LinkedIn post, 7 clips, along with the main piece of content. So 21 pieces of content per podcast, along with 2 high quality documentaries that are going out. So now all my social media channels are active and we went from 300K to 600K very easily. So again, coming back to that whole thing, that if you think of yourself as the center of everything, you can only go so far. But if you consider yourself as a part of something that's much bigger and you put, like you mentioned, systems and processes at the heart of it, you can grow much faster, much better, and with sustenance at its core, right? So, but my question is, bro, you know, I in fact spoke to Anshuman and he told me something very interesting about your podcast strategy. Okay, he was a part of your podcasting cohort and he told me that, dude, Ranveer has an entire machinery. Like, he is like bang on with his timing and content and strategy because they follow something called the machine gun strategy. Talk to me about the machine gun strategy.
Okay, wow. I thought that's a top secret.
Really?
No, it's not. I'm happy to share it, bro. I feel in our industry, you need to put out your learnings because it's too early in the Indian content ecosystem. And the guys who are like at the front should be telling the rest of the ecosystem what to do. If the ecosystem grows, genuinely, everyone will grow.
True.
So, I'll tell you what the machine gun strategy is. Short content is an art form, but it can be optimized to get views as well. The rules of short content change every 3 months.
Okay.
So this is the basis of it.
Every 3 months.
That's what I genuinely believe.
Okay.
I think in some phases, longer short pieces work. Longer short pieces. In some phases, shorter short pieces work. In some phases, people want to know certain things about certain topics. In some phases, people want the short content to be highly edited. In some phases, they don't want it to be edited. So the basis of the machine gun strategy is knowing where short content is at currently. Okay. Now, I sit on the advantage of not just producing 4 podcasts a week, but having a library of 700.
Okay.
Okay. So machine gun strategy in short is, if we feel that someone has given us a stellar podcast, we ensure that all our systems and processes are aligned to make the short content from that podcast explode on social media and reach everyone's algorithm.
Okay. How do you do that?
How do we edit out like all this?
Like, how do you make sure that it spreads out to an extent where it's everywhere on social media?
You just have to crack the short content. So okay. You have to crack the views game.
Let's take an example and understand this. Have you done this for one particular podcast recently?
Yeah. All of them almost now. If there's a film star. See, on some level, we know every good podcaster knows what to ask. I think the difference between a commercially successful podcaster and someone who just enjoys the art of podcasting is that the commercially successful guy knows how to play the numbers game, knows that at the end of the day, the views matter because views will bring you money. So everything that we do, first and foremost, is centered around getting results. I learned this from MythPat. I remember a phase where we went into niche podcasting and he said, dude, don't do this. You're a YouTuber, focus on the numbers. So I went away from the niche again because I don't think India was ready for niches at that point. And I think you're acing the niche game, by the way. India's ready for it.
I was just about to say that, bro. I'm the antithesis to this is.
This is back in 2019 or 2020. India evolves and you need to know where they're at. So the machine gun strategy is great for this year. For all you know, next year may not work. Right now, so this is a demand and supply angle. Okay. The way Instagram usage has increased in our country, as well as YouTube Shorts usage. There's a massive demand for short content from those platforms. Okay. The platforms want to be flooded with content. So we are just supplying the demand.
Got it. So if I were to summarize this, let's say there is one piece of content. What you do is you produce short form content in such a way that that particular platform gets what it requires. In case of YouTube, a YouTube short is curated far differently as compared to an Instagram reel.
Yeah. Instagram is more emotional. YouTube is more knowledge based.
Instagram is more emotional. YouTube is more knowledge based. This literally explains why we have never been able to grow on Instagram, bro.
You can, if you twist your niche to the emotions of it. So if I'm doing like a case study on Dhirubhai Ambani, talk about his family struggles. You know, he didn't have an easy passing away. Yeah. So there's always true, inspirational, emotional business stories.
Got it. And this is something that I can actually sense from the timing of your content. And I remember February 19th, you did a podcast with Nitin Gadkari, sir, way back. But then you posted about Chhatrapati Shivaji on Shiv Jayanti, which is on 19th of February. Then when
Gun mentality.
Yeah. And that's when then World Cup happened, and then you had content ready for the World Cup also. And after that, I still remember FIFA World Cup had happened and you were there.
I'll give you another angle when I have fun with this. Okay, now I know I've built out the machinery. So the machine gun is built out. Okay, all I have to do is point it in the direction I want it fired.
Oh.
So every human who's ever watched my content knows what a massive Virat Kohli fan I am. And there was some slander on Virat Kohli in the last week. My immediate response is I call my guys and say, put out all our positive Virat Kohli content to counter the algorithm.
But how do you document all of this, bro? Because you're doing so many podcasts. Like, if an editor sits down at the table, he's supposed to get into a particular SSD, access that particular podcast, check where you've spoken about Virat, and then there are multiple angles.
Not difficult. Everything's documented. Again, systems and processes. Like, again, one layer deep, engineering college. It teaches you to think in structure.
I'll actually send my team to understand the system and process, bro.
Bro, that's you crazy. Are an engineering college grad. I believe Parsh is also.
Yeah, he's also.
I'm pretty sure you're already doing this. Okay. It's just how we're taught to think. Even our non-engineering grads are taught to think according to what engineering college teaches us. Wow. We take that for granted when we've graduated. But like, for example, even if I'm talking to you, if you ask me, give me 4 points about this, there's automatically a graph drawn in my head where there are 4 empty slots and I'll fill it out. Often when I'm talking to people who have not graduated from engineering college, they get lost in that question because maybe they're not constructing that graph of 4 slots in their head. Now translate that into the systems and processes of your organization. On some level, no matter how artsy, creative, funny, bakchod we get, we are very black and white in terms of, hey, at the end of the day, we're running a corporate organization. And we're here for the long term. We're here to make money. We're here to grow and we're here to be number one.
Interesting. So the heart of all of this, in fact, the foundation of all of this is good documentation in such a way that today if a social media trend comes up, you know exactly what needs to be posted because of the documentation that has been done. And that's the foundation of your systems and processes. And then on top of that, when it's combined with good editing as well as the emotional angle, like you mentioned, Instagram is for emotions and YouTube is for knowledge. So if I were to picturize this and see how this is going to work with a case study, let's say tomorrow there is a lot of slander about, let's say, Hardik Pandya. And you've spoken about Hardik Pandya at multiple podcasts. The way this algorithm is going to function is that somebody identifies that this is what is the sentiment in the mind of the audience. But we need to push positive content about Hardik Pandya because that's what
because
is...
Because I like Hardik Pandya.
Because you like Hardik Pandya. And also because it is absolutely necessary, bro. Because... Again, it's too toxic, so there is a dire need for positive content out there. So, step number one is identify the sentiment of the audience. Hardik Pandya is negative, so you go positive. Then what you do is, when it comes to positive, all the emotional things go on Instagram. And that's where, you know, you use music over there, which is, I still remember, Manzar Naya is something that you've used multiple times.
That's the skill of my editors, especially someone called Akshat Tiwari. He's been with me since he was 17 years old when we used to work out of a garage. That first step, now recognizing the sentiment of the audience, that's the actual difficult step.
Oh, okay.
Everything else is easy. Even the edits are easy at this point. And he's also an engineering grad. So he approaches editing and processes as an engineer.
Interesting.
Yeah. And our edit room is very, very high quality. It is not easy to survive in our edit room. There is a lot of tough feedback. It's not a toxic environment. But it's a very sports mentality oriented environment. We're not a family, we're a sports team. So people are held responsible for things. A certain level of pace is required. A certain level of intensity and quality is required. I truly believe, bro, video content creators at the end of the day. we are a restaurant style business where our food is videos. So the cooks have to be of a certain caliber.
But tell me something, what is the turnaround time after identifying the sentiment of the audience? What's the turnaround time of posting, like, let's say, 7 pieces of content together?
1 hour, 2 hours.
What?
Yeah.
How do the editors edit it in 1 hour, bro?
9 years of building systems and processes.
Wow. And how many editors work on a particular reel or a short? One person.
One, yeah. But one really good editor. So we created...
Do you have like a template on which everything is built, or does this person start from scratch, bro?
Templates change every 3 months because short content changes.
And who decides on these templates?
We have regular discussions. I'm an editor at the end of the day. That's my biggest skill as a YouTuber. So Akki and me sit and we'll discuss about the editing switches. And I keep trying to talk to teenage editors because I feel like, I mean, the batch of teenagers keeps changing every year, right? Like, you have a new set of 18-year-olds every year. So you can pick up a lot from talking to very young guys and girls. Female editors add a very different flair to editing in general. They care a lot more about aesthetics for sure than the male editors. So a combination of a male and female edit room is also very, very, it's a very potent thing that we've learned a little late, because traditionally the editors are mostly male. I think a lot of young girls are taking up editing now. And I think they add a very, very different energy to like the edits. You're going to war, bro. You know, you need female warriors and male warriors there.
This is so interesting, bro. I never thought about Instagram and YouTube short so deeply. Like, the machine gun strategy is insane. Love it, bro. Lot of notes.
Am I making answers too long?
Nahi, bro. This is perfect.
Okay.
I'm taking notes from this. So when I show it to my team, they're going to take inspiration from this. And I see the way I do podcast is that if anybody watches our content should not be watch-worthy, it should be note-worthy. So if your notebook is filled with ThinkSchool notes, and bro, I'm not even kidding, there are people who post LinkedIn, there are people who put out LinkedIn posts saying that, you know, these are my ThinkSchool notes, and they are 300 pages long, bhai. 300 pages long, and that's what gives me utmost satisfaction, that I'm able to give people something that they can take notes from. Because after being a part of a shitty education system, like, this is the least that I can do to make sure that everybody's every minute is worthy enough. So all your answers, they're perfect because they're giving me enough notes. So I'm assuming that if there's a kid who's watching it, or if there's a podcaster who's watching this, they will take back something to be able to do something much better. So now I want to come back to your story. So now I understand what lies at the heart of BeerBiceps, the organization. It's not BeerBiceps, the creator. It is BeerBiceps. It's Ranveer Allahbadia, the entrepreneur, who's doing all of this. B, it is not a creative organization as much as it is a systems and process-driven organization with creativity as one little part of it. But it is laying on the foundation of systems and processes. Now talk to me about the evolution of these systems and processes in the beginning of your career. 2015, you started. 2016, the Jio wave happened. And then I think you started growing faster because of you started hit a certain benchmark. And then you started posting talking head videos, just like I do today, which is sitting in front of the camera and speaking to the camera. Tuesday, Friday, you go on. And that is how you start expanding. And then when did Monkey happen?
I don't remember now whether it was 2017 or 2018, honestly. I think it was 2017. Yeah, it was 2017. April, I met Viraj for the first time because he is 2 years younger than I am. So he was just about to graduate. You graduate in June and I met him in April. Literally told him, I'll give you a 20% cut if you can crack any brand deal for me.
But why did you choose Viraj?
Just we had a work equation in college. We had worked on a certain project in college, and there's a term that I've learned now. It's from the startup world. It's called... getting into bed with someone, something like that. It basically means trying to work a little bit on small projects, figuring out work chemistry, and then taking it forward. So again, this was a mathematical like decision that we have work chemistry. And then, bro, the rest is history. Like, he's also an intense guy. He cracked deals based on his own intensity. So I think people know the story of Monkey Ki. I had YouTuber friends. There was a need for talent management. And we had... set up systems and processes for talent managing Ranveer.
So were you always like systems and process driven?
It's gotten stronger with age. Okay. We have Manish Pandey, who you also know. He really like kind of rubbed it in. He rubbed in the importance of it because he comes from a corporate background, just like yourself. You guys worked at Reliance, I think, together. So he brought in that corporatization. And Manish Pandey has mentored someone called Nachiket Nisal, who I think you know as well. Nachiket is also an engineering grad, you know, kind of groomed on one side by Manish Pandey, the other side by me. So he has that balance of art as well as systems. And mine and his obsession is constantly engineering things better.
Interesting.
For efficiency, because that's the basis of simple machines. Like, what's the usage of a lever? What's the usage of a pulley? That's what you learn in engineering college. It's to make your life easier. So systems and processes are extremely difficult to construct because it requires a certain level of observation and problem solving. But if you're able to do it, it can make your life way easier. Like Jai Shetty had said this in a podcast with me. He said that discipline is very difficult to adopt into your life, but the gift of discipline is that it makes your life easier. Now apply that to a professional environment. Systems and processes are very difficult to adopt into the organization, but the gift of systems and processes is that it makes the work more powerful. So very crucial. Again, we talk about systems and processes, but it's not an easy. It's something you get better at with time. Experience plays a role. Culture plays a role. And I might be biased here, but I truly believe that engineering grads play a role.
They do, bro. They do, for sure. I'll tell you why. And this is completely my opinion. Because we are crushed under so much pressure that we just, our survival instinct is to become more efficient. You know, there are so many assignments. And at the same time, there's so much of stupid things to do with your friends. I'm not using that word, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. Talking about joints and mugs.
Yeah. There are so many stupid things to do with our friends that it is important that you have fun. At the same time, you complete all the shit that you've got so that you don't get scolding the next day. Or you don't get rusticated the next day because there's enormous amount of pressure. At the same time, you're doing something that you absolutely hate doing. So you always find the fastest way to complete it in such a way that you're relieved and then you can go back to having fun. And more importantly, what I also think is that because engineering puts in so much of pressure on you that you understand the importance of not doing something that you love for 4 years. And that gives you a crash course and a reflection also. In fact, I got this reflection that I did civil engineering from a very shitty college. And every day of my life, bro, I'm not even kidding. Every single day of my life, and I used to go to that classroom, I used to feel like, what the hell am I doing? I've studied 40 subjects, cleared all of them, spent a gazillion hours at college. Bro, I couldn't understand a single lecture. Single. And my friends were like, they were extremely focused. They used to take notes. Bro, you know, I used to carry only one book in my bag. One book. Professor somehow expected that you will have a different notebook for every subject, just like school. And I still remember there was this professor called Arif Bhagwan. He came to my desk. And so on the first page, everything was very well written, okay? All math. And then he turned the page, bro. And I can't even describe what he saw.
What?
Okay. I can't say that out in front of the camera, but it was just some random stuff along with his own drawing over there, which was made by me and Mayur. Bro, it was terrible, bro. And thankfully he did not, I don't know if he saw that or not, but then he just turned the page and this guy started laughing. So he's like, dude, what is happening? He was surprised, bro. He was taken aback. Okay, and bro, I was so stupid in college that there are two subjects. One is called transportation engineering. The other is called infrastructure engineering. So transportation engineering, I think you study that in your second year. And infrastructure is what you study in your third year. Bro, in my third year, I wrote transportation engineering as the name of the subject on my exam paper. The invigilator came in and he asked me, bro, are you from second year or third year? I said, sir, I'm from third year. So you write transportation ka paper? So I said, transportation is chal raha hai na. And I had a friend named Sangram and he's like, Ganya, apan third year mein hai, infrastructure chal raha hai, tu infrastructure hi padh ke aaya na. I was like, sorry, bro. And then I changed the subject name, bro, and everybody was like, dude, what is this guy? Like, he has just learned everything for the sake of passing. The invigilator is like, who is this random kid, dude? He doesn't even know what subject he's writing for. And I was not surprised because I never looked at the subject name itself. In fact, when I went for a viva, bro, you know what my professor asked me? She asked me three questions. I started giving random answers. She said, don't talk in English. Explain this thing in Hindi. Because I know that you can speak English well, but I know that you don't know the answers. So you know what was the last question she asked me? She told me, Ganesh, ye sab chhod do. फ्लूइड मैकेनिक्स छोड़ दो, आप बस मुझे इतना बताओ कि अपने टेक्स्ट बुक में जो 6 यूनिट्स है ना उनका बस मुझे नाम बता दो. आई वाज लाइक डूड दिस इज द मोस्ट डिफिकल्ट क्वेश्चन इन माय लाइफ एंड आई वाज जस्ट थिंकिंग देयर इज दिस एक्सटर्नल वाइवा गाय हु हैड कम इन एंड ही वाज लाइक डूड लाइक व्हाट द f-. एंड आई सेड आई एम सो सॉरी सर बट आई डोंट नो द नेम ऑफ द यूनिट्स बट आई नो द आंसर्स. एंड मैं गिन के 3 आंसर्स रट के गया था और मैंने वो बोला और मैं बाहर निकला. ब्रो एवरी टाइम आई गॉट एन आई वाज लाइक व्हाई एम आई ऑलवेज पुट इन दिस एम्बैरेसिंग सिचुएशन एंड दैट वाज डीप डाउन इट वाज ओनली बिकॉज ऑफ वन रीजन बिकॉज आई डिड नॉट लव व्हाट आई वाज डूइंग. सो आई हैड ऑल द रॉन्ग इंप्रेशंस अबाउट माई सेल्फ. आई फेल्ट लाइक आई वाज नॉट फोकस्ड. आई फेल्ट लाइक आई वाज एक्सट्रीमली इरिटेटेड. माई मेंटल हेल्थ हैड गॉन फॉर अ टॉस एंड दैट्स व्हेन आई आस्क्ड मायसेल्फ वन क्वेश्चन. एम आई गोइंग टू फील लाइक दिस फॉर द रेस्ट ऑफ माई लाइफ? And while everybody was sitting down for placements, I just asked myself that one question over and over and over again. Do I want to do this for the rest of my life? And the answer was always no. I said, even if I get a job that's going to pay me 30 to 50K, is this something that I would want to feel in my office? And 20 years later, and that's when I studied the regret minimization framework of Jeff Bezos. And he said that when you're 80 and you're lying on your deathbed, when you look back at the decisions that you've made, would you be glad to have made those decisions? And even if you fail, when you're on your deathbed, at least that's going to give you enough relief that you tried something and it did not happen versus you not trying at all. And that is when I decided I'm going to get off this and I'm going to do something that I truly love. And the moment you find something that you like a little bit, you feel like, dude, this is such a new feeling because for 4 years you've never had that feeling. And then when you start doing it, then you're like, this is my calling. And that grind is still there because you had grinded a lot, it's just that it was not in the right direction. But the moment you find something that you absolutely love, and then you put in that 14 hours of work, then you spend sleepless nights, then you put in the hustle, and then you start bearing the fruit of it, that's when you realize that you've come a long way from grinding for the wrong reason to grinding for the right reason. That, I think, is the fundamental reason why I've spoken to so many people, so many engineers who've done some random things, bro, starting from a stand-up comedian to an artist to YouTubers. The one thing that's very common is that, bro, I hated college.
Yeah.
I was grinding for the wrong reason. And then when I realized that I could do this for the right reasons, it gave me enough dopamine to keep going for the next 2 to 3 years. And more importantly, because you're insulted so many times by professors, by the guys, especially guys, that you just become immune to insult. So tomorrow when the relative comes in and throws shit at you, you're like, dude, I have gotten much worse shit than this, so I can bear it. So that immunity, that I would say Teflon coating to bear the insult, also comes in very handy. And all of these things put together, they shape your character and they make it so goddamn strong that you're focused, that you know what you need to do, and people's opinion doesn't really matter so much. And that's what gets you going.
This is why I get pissed off with the question of, hey, do you get affected by online hate? Hey, do you get affected by trolls? It's a question content creators get everywhere. And my answer is always the same. I tell them I've been through engineering college, bro. You don't know what I've gone through in my life. This is nothing. So, man, like, I also honestly believe that the content creators who are engineering grads are usually more immune to online hate and trolling. And I feel it is a skill that this job requires. You need to have that little thick skin, but we've been through engineering college.
Bro, I was in civil engineering, aur wahan pe na, jab main khada hoke kuch bhi English mein bolta tha na, all my civil engineering, because they were from random villages or the sons of extremely big builders, and they did not give a shit about English. Okay, and English is like, okay. So whenever I used to stand up, bro, bhara classroom hai, 80 bacche baithe hue hain, professor hai, jo bahut strict hai, main khade hoke kuch answer de raha hu, jo mujhe bhi itne acche se pata nahi hai. I'm just trying to just make up for the question that he's asked me, because he's caught me doing something mischievous. But the moment I stand up, and the moment I utter the first word in English, everybody's like, 80 people doing this to you, bro. Hey, Ganaya, kya re, English, bro, what is that, bro? And imagine me delivering a presentation during my final year project where all of these guys are just sitting over here. They had nothing against me. They would just have a lot of fun making fun of me. So I was like so immune to everything of taking things the right way and taking it so sportively that this Teflon coating just eventually became such a handy thing. And I'm so thankful for all the things that have happened. So this happens in such a way that the trolling and this makes you take things sportingly. I've never been trolled as much as you are, so I don't have that experience. But I can say this for sure, that whenever somebody makes fun of me, even I laugh with them because it's a good joke, A, and B, because it has been done to me before. Similarly, when it comes to the professors, they insult you with a lot of harshness. And that literally like screws with your, I would say, self-confidence.
You know, it's the viciousness that they have towards their own inner child.
Yeah. And you can literally feel it, because there are professors, you know that they are extremely troubled souls, and they just throw all that shit at you with so much intensity that it gets to you after a certain point. And then when you realize that after 4 years that you've gotten used to it, then no matter how much toxicity a person has, it doesn't rub on you because you're just used to it.
Yeah, I love going back to college. I've only been there like once or twice. And the first time I went there, I recruited Viraj for Monk Entertainment.
Okay.
But one of the reasons I try not going back to college often is because I know that if I see certain professors, I'll want to throw a little slander, and that's not befitting of like a 30-year-old man. You know, why the... Can I cuss?
Yeah, yeah.
Why the f*** should I like go and affect someone's day negatively? But yeah, dude, like only the backbenchers in engineering colleges know what they've been through.
Yeah.
From the guys, from like the professors. Very, very mentally challenging. You keep changing as a person, but the ability to change just becomes faster through engineering college. Again, systems and processes with respect to oneself, and then obviously what you said about toughness.
True. Have you felt that?
Dude, I have a very low self-opinion, and I have a positive relationship with having a low self-opinion.
Okay.
But that low self-opinion has definitely formed in engineering college. I'm very okay to
what
have...
What do you mean by low self-opinion?
Thinking you've not made it yet. Thinking that there's so much of a long way to go. Some would call this whatever mama mentality, you know, trying to get better every day. But it comes from a place of feeling like you're not good enough yet. And that genuinely comes from college.
True.
From 4 years of being told you're a piece of shit. You're a
True.
Piece of shit. You're a piece of shit. So then it does stick around for life. And I've probably not let go of that also because it's become a strength. I know that we are here because of self-improvement. The need for self-improvement comes from a low self-opinion, which comes from engineering college.
You know, a lot of people often tell me, and they also speak about you in the same way, that you guys do not have any insecurity. That is the reason why you're able to put yourself in front of the camera. And that's when I often tell them that, dude, we have so many insecurities. That is the reason why we are able to get better with each passing video. Because in this field, if you just feel secured, then your growth will actually stagnate. You have to feel insecure, and that insecurity should lead to introspection. That introspection should lead to better feedback taking, and that better feedback taking will eventually help you to become a better person. Because once you have like a million followers, a million subscribers, at least in the society that you live in, you are an elevated person, you know, you have transcended to a different level. But that, in a way, if that leads to security and this God complex, as they call it, that is the place where you start your downfall, right? Bro, but tell me something. I wanted to always understand, and this is perhaps the question that's going to come from a million other people. Why do you talk about tantric, yeti, and also sex? What is the logic behind it? Because if I look at your evolution, you started from fitness, then went to fashion, and then there is something that changed over there, which suddenly got you into NoFap. And I remember, in fact, NoFap is extremely popular because of you. So from NoFap to then tantric, to God, to Hanuman, to sex. I mean, it just doesn't add up, but somehow it's worked for you. Like, how is that?
So, two angles here. One is that I'm actually a really, really curious person. And the curiosity is not limited to any topic other than politics. Okay, I hate politics.
Really?
Like, yeah, I hate politics. I think it's a great study of human psychology. But even the way political discussion happens in a country, either it's too aggressive or it's too recent in terms of points brought forward in debates. And I'm all for evergreen conversation. So even with the podcast, I want to be able to record podcasts that will be relevant 10, 20 years from now. And that only doesn't happen within political conversations. But in terms of understanding human psychology, I love politics. I love speaking to politicians to understand the human behind the superhero that the masses know. So curiosity is one aspect, and I've always been a curious person. Like, in my childhood, the first few books that I read were related to UFOs.
Okay.
And to like the paranormal. And these are my actual subjects. Like, this is the kind of shit that I've been speaking about for years and that I will speak about for years, because I just enjoy these subjects. It's like always fun to have that little bit of cinema and conversation. The second aspect about all these is, on the surface, it sounds like the words like Yeti, Alien, NoFap, Bhoot, or Sex. When you actually unlock those topics and go within them, which is what a lot of people don't do, it opens up a whole realm of different subjects. For example, say if you take up the word Tantric, okay? When I say the word Tantric to you, you're probably visualizing a shirtless guy in a black dhoti playing with powder and like sparks. The word Tantra in our traditions means technique. Okay, so I'm a martial artist, done a lot of judo in my life. Judo and martial arts generally is about physical techniques. Now, be that about exercise or be that about the actual kick, punch, throw, whatever. When I discovered meditation in life, I realized, oh, in the same way that there are physical techniques, there are mental techniques as well. An easy way to understand mental technique is deep breathing or anulom vilom pranayam, how you feel calm. But that's level one. Breathing techniques can be so elaborate that it can have a very profound effect on your mind, your consciousness, your sense of the world, your creativity, your professional life, your relationships, all that. The word Tantra loosely translates to technique again. So if you actually deep dive into what Tantra means, why are rituals in the first place, it unlocks certain dimensions within you if you put it into practice and experience those things. But on the surface level, it sounds like Tantric. And that's why most people won't even go into that content, because they are trivializing the subject. But I think that the mind that perceives the limitation is the limitation. So if you go open-ended into any subject, you'll find value. And I've seen that those subjects, because of the esoteric depth of it, adds a lot more value to my life than for what for me are surface level subjects like finance, politics, what else is surface level, man? Fashion, etc. Like, I value these subjects as much as I value physical health. Yeah. But that's after doing countless podcasts about this stuff, etc. I do feel like they get rejected a lot just because we are told as a society that as you're growing up, when you go from being a child to being an adult, you have to reject certain ideas. But what if you don't reject them, hang on to them, deep dive into them, open them up, there'll be some value you'll gain for your life.
The reason why I'm one of those people who often rejects these subjects, and the reason why
it's not just you, bro. That's most people.
Yeah, and I'll tell you also the reason why I often tend to reject these things, because of two reasons. A, I know for a fact that, or at least I believe for a fact that tomorrow it's not going to change my life so much as a finance episode is going to change my life, or as much as a deeper understanding of what's happening in the world is going to change my life. Because I can go on and on. Like, you know, I've been so selective in terms of the content that I watch from you that I often tend to watch geopolitics, economics, politics, and anything where you talk about business, about beer biceps in general. I'm so fascinated by beer biceps, the business, that somehow or the other, I don't see you as a creator at all. Like, I do not consume any of your contents, but I consume your business acumen way more than the content that you produce. And the reason why this rejection comes in is because deep down, a lot of people are agnos. As in, until there is an incident that happens in their life which showcases a living proof of the existence of certain things, none of that really matters. And the people that I've spoken to who often consume your content, they felt something in their life because of which they tend to resonate with it. And bro, when it comes to social media also, you know, whenever you try to post something that is completely out of the box, I try to understand what is the logic behind this. There may or may not be a logic behind that, but then somehow I feel like there is always a logic. So I went to Spotify to try and see which are the top 10 performing podcasts in the country. So the top 10 podcast message, jo top two the, one was Bhagavad Gita, and the other was something on the lines of love stories. Okay, and I was like, okay. So there is, and then this was my hypothesis, that Ranveer saw which are the top performing contents in the industry right now. One of the best ways to look at it would be to look at other YouTube contents or something like Spotify. Spotify is a much more sorted platform because it has very less content. Over there, if somebody is listening to Bhagavad Gita more than they're listening to, let's say, some finance-related podcast, there could be a very good possibility that that content will do well. And maybe you experimented with that and then it just blew up. And I also see your evolution. When you started producing podcasts, you also started doing vlogging. And I also remember that you and Manish sir, you went to Varanasi and there was some conversation that was happening between you guys and it was too horrific. So I just said, let's not watch this at night. So what I see you doing is that you evolve so much on the basis of data and trend that you somehow become a chameleon in the social media algorithm where you just fit so perfectly in with what's happening right now that it eventually gives you more relevance. And then that helps you talk about contents that are not so relevant. And that's where you become an instrument of relevance. So it's almost like a virtuous cycle. You pick something that is absolutely relevant. You make yourself more relevant. And with that relevance, then you fuel relevance to things that are not relevant. Then those things become relevant. Eventually, that fuels more growth. Podcasting being one of those things. So my question is my hypothesis right in terms of how you think about producing the next leap of content?
I love playing football with you and I love hanging with you. But no, it's not right. So I know on the surface it seems that way that like, oh, the Bhagavad Gita podcast is doing well, oh, the Lust toy is doing well, I'll do this. But in truth, I feel like content creation is an outcome of you as a human being. The only two things I do very strategically are approaching each platform with its own editing and writing nuances. Okay. And the second thing I do strategically is I've always been a quantity-oriented content creator. All these are subjects that I really enjoy.
Quantity-oriented content creator?
Yes. Like Agastya Shah, like Flying Beast.
What does that mean? Does that mean you just post too much?
You're either a machine gun or you're a sniper. I think you're more in a sniper mold. Yeah. You're somewhat of a combination, but you're more in a sniper mold. I'm more in like a machine gun mold. So
how does that give you an advantage?
A-B testing happens faster. Okay. You're ready to take the L like more because you're okay to like let a piece fail. You're okay to take more criticism. So you can shape up your game better. Then you optimize for whatever you want to do. So if you want to optimize for money, optimize for money. If you want to optimize for fame, do that. But I think every human has their own natural strengths and it's important to know that, especially in content creation. In terms of behind the content, who is the human and what is that human's natural strengths? And then mold your content according to that. So even in football, I'm always the guy who runs around more than actually touching the ball. Like I want to make more of an impact through my stamina than I make through my technique.
Interesting. So from what I can sense from this is that you're not a guy who goes outward. I mean, you're not the guy who goes inward. You're the guy who goes outward. You don't go from what's happening in the market to understanding what you should do. You look at what you want to do and then eventually you do it at scale.
Yes.
In such high quantities that you eventually figure out what does well in the market and then you optimize for
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
Is that
yeah,
correct?
Yeah.
Hmm. But weren't you ever worried about your image? Because bro, I think about branding and positioning so obsessively that so I consider myself to be an ardent student of Steve Jobs. Okay. I study Steve Jobs obsessively. And once upon a time, Steve Jobs was famously asked that, you know what, Microsoft has a 95%, 96% market share and Apple is not even 5%. Like, why aren't you scaling up? And why aren't you trying to match the level of Microsoft in terms of distribution, in terms of accessibility, in terms of interoperability? Bro, Steve Jobs said one sentence. He said that the problem with Apple is that we can't ship junk. I was like, dude, this is what I want to do. So every piece of content that I put out, I overthink, I obsess over it so much that I'm like, if tomorrow, if I look back at this piece of content and I feel like I've compromised even a little bit, I will feel like I've done injustice to what I've built. So I'm so obsessed with that I do not try too much. And every time I try, it's very strategic in terms of experimenting. Those are all calculative risks and they are not. There has never been a video which I just put out and say, dekhte hain kya hota hai. But then when I see your approach, it's completely the opposite. You say, let's put out 10, 15 pieces of content, 5 or 6 of them will fly. And on the basis of what flies, then let's put out 5 to 10 pieces of content more on the basis of our experiment, which will then help us put more contents, which will give us more viewership, at the same time deliver more value.
And at the core of all this is fun. like I need to enjoy these topics. So and also about the branding thing, I feel like branding, especially in our country, is an outcome of numbers to a large degree. Something I learned from the gaming world, something I learned from Gary Minati, all these guys. Numbers are deeply respected in our country. I do believe that because we're urban guys and urban women watching this, we have a Western way of looking at things, which also has its place. I think if you want to sell to an urban audience only, this is the way to go. You have to like think too much about branding. If I launch a D2C brand that's very, you know, like targeted towards urban audiences, I will open up all of Steve Jobs' books and like download it. But in my eyes, I'm not running Z English or Z News. I'm running Z TV. So like, I know that my main game is masses.
But doesn't that make you feel like you're losing your identity? Because initially you were the fitness guy and then you became the fashion guy and then you became the spirituality guy. And now you are deviating even further to be a podcaster. So don't you feel insecure about the dilution of your identity?
Like that people take it less seriously?
Yes.
I think the kind of distribution that we've built and that we're going to build further will make everyone take one seriously.
How is that, bro?
I see that in how people treat me at events. We don't leave. See, I'm shooting every day. So I travel once in like 2 months. I go for very, very selected events. I see the way people come up to me and people's energy always speaks before their words. So very rarely do I meet people who kind of go like, oh, that guy, he's like the, you know, he's the bhoot guy, whatever. And obviously there are people like that from a distance, but I'm reaching out to the world's top cricketers, the world's top film stars, the world's top business professionals, at least in India. I know I'm doing something right, but much more importantly than what people think, I'm having a lot of fun doing this. So, and I'm paying the bills. I have a 60-member organization just helping me with this. Yeah. So, again, I'm not one of those people to go into like self. I was going to use a much more crass angle, but I don't want to gloat. But if you're putting the food on the table for like so many people, we have 400 people working across the organizations. And on some level, BeerBiceps is the opening batsman. So I live a very fulfilled life. Everything's going upwards, money, fame, numbers, clout. But all that aside, I'm really enjoying my life. And I don't want to trade away the enjoyment with the need for great branding. I think the rules of PR are changing very drastically. Very drastically. The internet has a very short memory and being a chameleon has its own advantages. I know I'm not in this game for a limited amount of time. There could be a possibility that I could be there for 50 years. There could be a possibility that I could go by the time I'm 40 years of age. You shouldn't be taking, I look at it that way, branding and PR as seriously as a lot of PR and branding professionals tell you, because they come from an old world which was a lot less moldable. I think social media has made media in general much more moldable. You don't need to be afraid about bad PR phases because it will be backed up by a good PR phase as long as you're working hard and working towards it. And I also feel that, again, the internet has a very short memory, man. So if your numbers are going up, numbers are distribution is power. You will have the ability to change a bad PR phase without taking too much tension about it. But again, what I truly, truly insist on is being self-satisfied and having fun with the process. If you're not enjoying it, it's not worth it. And I have a little bit of a philosophical angle on this, which is that every human has two deaths. One is where the physical body dies. The second is where your name is taken for the last time on this planet. So there will be a day like that eventually. Maybe it'll be 1,000 years later, but it will happen. So you can't take life and career that seriously if you're living life and if you're living your career out as an artist. Like, you have to let your art express itself also. So while the tantric yeti stuff, it creates its own stir, what it also does is it creates a lot of numbers. It makes me feel very enjoyable about the process. And it definitely unlocks some kind of dimensions in terms of thought and creativity. For example, I've deep dived so much into tantra and shastra and all these because of those episodes that seem like they're about ghosts and tantrics at the top, that it affects my nature of how I look back at my parental relationship. As in my relationship with my parent, it's benefited my romantic relationship. It's benefited all my friendships. It's benefited my sense of empathy. And then all that kind of compounds and makes its way into your professional skill set as well. So there's like, you know, knowledge never goes to waste. And just because these subjects on the surface seem trivial or childlike doesn't mean that they don't contain very, very deep philosophy and knowledge within it. For example, like, let's just take a Yeti and open up that subject. A Yeti is supposedly a mythical creature. It led me to many more conversations about the Himalayas. It led me to conversations with army personnel where they've told me things that they're not allowed to say on camera, classified information, etc. And I know so much like background stuff about our country because of those conversations that I know what I bring to a room. Secondly, like, even when it comes to the Yeti, it led me into this deep dive into the megafauna that the earth has lost. So all the animals that we see around us right now are 1% of the total animals that have ever existed. And you could easily count the Yeti as one of those animals that we've just not discovered because maybe there's very few left. You know, this whole thing about crocodiles living till 150 years. What if the Yeti is also a creature like that lives like for 150, 200 years? So it unlocks certain elements of curiosity. Now, I link the Yeti to the crocodile. I can go and do a crazy wildlife podcast because I have that kind of a knowledge set. So if I'm doing the Tantra and Yeti stuff, it's also giving me some kind of weapons that I can use in a podcast with a celebrity, in a podcast with a politician, in a podcast with an actor.
So it's basically your inner child who is extremely curious, trying to quench his thirst of curiosity through these pieces of information. That's the first part. And the second part is what goes out there, how the public reacts to it and stuff like that. But at the heart of it, you're doing what you absolutely love. You're enjoying the process. It's making you money. It's putting food on the plates of so many people. It's serving so many families. So you're like, this is what I want to do.
I'm like, I'm having fun. And very importantly, I'm making money. I think there's no point of money without fun and no point of fun without money. So it goes hand in hand, man.
Bro, this is completely the opposite of how I think. Like, it's completely the opposite, okay? So the way I think about every piece of content is that, is this something that somebody like Nikhil Kamath or some great entrepreneur would watch and take something back? If it doesn't cross that bar, I will not post it at all. And that also results into a lot of scrapping of content. I have a team of 4 people and they are more than capable of producing 16 pieces of content a month. But we produce only 5 or 6. We just scrap out the rest 10. Because we feel like every minute is supposed to be worthy. Every minute has to be crafted in such a way that can bring out the true essence of the subject that we are covering. And we also go to an extent where when we make a case study on something like quick commerce, and this is like my favorite case study because we put in so much efforts into it. It took us 3 months to make, where we spoke to every single delivery boy, spoke to the warehouse guys, tried to understand the market, even reached out to the founder of Swiggy. And by the way, he turned out to be a subscriber of thinkschool. And I was like so happy about it. And every time I have these conversations, a kind of pressure builds up saying that, you know, I have to deliver content which is so high quality that somebody like Nikhil Kamath or somebody like the founders of Swiggy will find value in this. So when I speak about Blinkit or when I speak about Swiggy, I have to be extremely careful so that I don't lose that reputation. At the same time, because it is information about a particular business, there is also this fear factor that, you know, I should not disrespect an entrepreneur because an entrepreneur is building something with so much of effort, so much of hard work, and some random kid on YouTube should not disrespect the kind of work that they have done
and
without having enough data.
And there's a lot of those, and I don't put you in that category at all. One of the reasons that I even noticed thinkschool in the first place was that there was a sense of deep understanding, observation, as well as a like genuinity and goodness. I think where there's genuinity and goodness, there isn't space for slander, honestly, especially publicly.
True.
You know, like, there's so many slander-oriented YouTube channels, and I'm not talking about roasting. I think roasting is cute and fun. I'm talking about slander. They don't know the kind of damage that they're causing their own professional life in the long term.
Correct.
And I think it's very important to put out positive energy because it returns. And if you put out negative energy, trust me, it's going to return. when you're doing it on YouTube, you have that kind of platform. Imagine building a platform out of slander and putting it out for the world. Someday, you're going to pay the price.
And the world has enough toxicity that you don't need to add to that. And more importantly, what I also felt is that when we produce content, even when we criticize the government, and I get a lot of hate for it, that when we criticize the government, we criticize them respectfully. Okay, and there are a lot of creators who criticize the government disrespectfully. And when I started speaking to a few of these creators who often tend to criticize the government, when I asked them, if you become the finance minister of the country, what would you do? And I put two or three constraints on them, they don't have an answer. For example, I spoke to one of these guys and I was having this conversation because this guy put out a tweet. I asked him, bro, so tell me, what exactly is your complaint with the government? And I understand your criticism. I'm just trying to understand the logic behind it. So he said, inflation is increasing so much. What is the government doing for it? I said, okay, great. So you know why is inflation increasing? Because US has printed a lot of money. So if you have a kilo of mangoes over here that are selling for 500 rupees a kilo over there in the US, because US has printed money, a lot of people have money, so they're willing to pay 5,000 rupees a kilo. So if you were the farmer who was trading with mangoes, what would you do? Would you export your products to the US or sell it over here for 500 rupees where the customer is crying to even pay 500 rupees? He said, I would ship it to the US. If you ship it to the US, then the supply is going to decrease, as a result of which you are bound to increase your price for two reasons. A, shortage. B, because there you're getting a better price. So you'll tell the Indian consumer, you either pay 1,000 rupees a kilo or I'm going to ship it to the US. So what can Modi ji do over here? Tell me something. There is a record which says that every time inflation crosses 10%, the government topples. What benefit is the government going to get out of this when they know all this data? Number two, the maximum that RBI can do is increase the repo rate. So if you increase the repo rate, your home loan interest is going to increase. Then the common people will cry saying that, "Arey, our home loan interests are going up. So because of which we're not able to spend enough money and that's causing a cash crunch." But if the RBI decreases repo rate, then the inflation is going to increase. Again, if you were the FM, what would you do? No answer. So after a certain point, what I understood is that when I am given a chance to criticize the government, I am supposed to criticize the government by asking myself one question. If I were that person and if I were to listen to this criticism, how can I change something constructively?
And if it more as a coach, less as a critic.
Yes. And if I'm not able to change that, and if I'm being criticized for a position that I am in for no fault of mine because of external factors that are well beyond my control, then I would consider that to be a disrespectful criticism. And here's where my experimenting kind of dies down, because I have to be so constructive, so respectful to whatever I'm doing that I can't optimize for views whatsoever.
I think you are, bro.
Bro, not really. Because when we compare the kind of views that we get as compared to other people, it's just 10x, 20x. And what we do is like far limited. And here's where there is this constraint that often hits me, that why are we, I mean, this is something that my editors often ask me, my friends often ask me, why don't you go that route which is going to give you exponential growth and you know of it? And the only reason over there is that I don't in any way want to disrespect someone to an extent where whatever work they've done, that gets disregarded.
I have something to say, but it's a little tough love. I literally don't see anything wrong in any of your content strategy, you, processes, etc. But I'm passing on a baton that Prajakta passed on to me, and she's the reason that I took up the decision. I feel like switching to Hindi will just change the game.
We've actually started a Hindi channel.
I know. That's why I'm like, this is as far as my tough love gets. In terms of your own dilemma about dude bait, but how do I take it to the next level? You're already doing it. So I really think you're already on the right path, and you'll truly see the power of the Hindi audience. I also genuinely believe that the English speaking audience in our country is not loyal as an audience. They'll move on to the next person as soon as they gain value there. The reason that the Hindi audience watches content is very different than the reason people like you and me watch content.
Okay.
People like you and me watch content for us. In the Hindi audience, yes, that is the case. That's the basis of content. But they'll watch content for the content creator. And there's a certain sense of respect and love and adulation which they watch it with, which results in a very powerful journey over time when it compounds. So I think carry on, because you're also honestly, you know, Shah Rukh Khan says he's the last of the stars. Ganesh Prasad is the last of the YouTubers.
What are you saying, bro?
Yeah. You know how many of your professors shat on you? It sowed in the seed of intensity. Other than Agastya Shah, I see the intensity missing with a lot of the new gen of creators.
But what do you mean intensity?
So you need intensity. You need to have that will to take it to the next level, not be satisfied, grow, make money, not stop, not keep a glass ceiling on yourself. I don't know what's going wrong. I kind of think it's like Instagram paying really well. That's definitely a part of it, that we have 19-year-olds, 21-year-olds taking home like fucking 20 lakhs a month. Doesn't give one the motivation to create long-form content and then build out even further. They're very happy staying in that 20 lakh a month range because perhaps the ambition is also just limited to traveling and getting good sneakers and wearing nice clothes and being invited for parties. And 9 years into this job, there are definitely lots of parties. There are definitely lots of good clothes and sneakers. But then what? The upgrade on that is just you're invited to a better party. You get a better sneaker. You get better clothes. Are you creating an impact on society? You know, I personally, like my goal with my career, my goal with my life is to pursue my spiritual journey fully and dedicate most of my time to meditation and my practice and all that. Can't do that because I've signed up for this long-term journey. Lots of people have left great jobs to be with me, left other opportunities to be with me. The football guy in me owes my teammates, you know, a great game. But if I had to, like, really chalk out what is my material goal with this? I believe I'll stop when I have 100 crores of personal wealth in savings and then just allow that wealth to multiply for myself. And the second point of stopping is when I feel, so we're working on, again, this is not me marketing, but I'm genuinely saying that this is what it is. We have something called the BeerBiceps Foundation, which has been active for like 2-3 years. And I began it because I was feeling very empty about my career. In terms of, yes, I'm growing, but not giving back to society. We have 5 or 6 things that we do through the foundation. But again, my angle on running a non-profit organization is that it should be profitable enough to pay for itself. So pay for itself and grow. So when I'm able to take that BeerBiceps Foundation and make it its own beast, where it's making money as well as fueling itself, then I'll feel that sense of satisfaction about my material career. So it's just these two tick marks.
Bro, what a coincidence, bro. We are about to start the thinkschool Foundation, and it's been a month that we've been ideating on it, and we're starting with dog shelter. And this is the exact same feeling. And I was like, okay, now we've built something very significant. What do we do next? Let's just build a non-profit. That is so interesting.
There's no point of money, man.
So what you're saying is most of the creators often lose out on greatness because they often optimize for short-term things like money and sneakers and parties.
And sex.
And sex. Because of which they're not able to get into the next realm of what content has to offer, what social media has to offer, which is
impact,
which is employment, which is impact in terms of not just of what people consume, but also about how people think and shaping opinions and narratives.
You can affect the world through that one ripple you create. That's one genuine learning about content creation that I've had.
And also because there is so much more money to be made, bro. Like, we don't speak about our numbers very publicly, but I know for a fact that I have at least 5 other friends who can make 5x, 6x more money if they only do YouTube well. And, you know, we were just having this conversation with a few brands lately, wherein they were just telling us that when it comes to Instagram content creators, they're not investing so heavily. Back then they used to, which is 2 years back, all brands were so bullish on Instagram that we were falling short of sponsors on YouTube. And we were like, dude, we are putting out content which is 10 minutes long, 20 minutes long. So every week, thinkschool produces at least 40 minutes worth of content. Whereas the Instagram creators, they barely produce 5-6 minutes worth of content. The value here is obviously way higher as compared to there. The audience is more loyal. There, the audience is not at all loyal. Here, you have a link in the description by default. There, you have to go to the bio and click. So the conversion rates are very less. Here, in YouTube, the state of mind of the person while they consume content is about seeking something, whether that's education, advice, or anything. Over there, it's merely entertainment. So the state of mind is very fickle because obviously the conversion will obviously drop down. So why are all the brands going bullish on Instagram? Bro, turns out even the brands were driven by instant gratification, whereby they just wanted to show number of clicks to their investors, number of app downloads to their investors versus optimizing for the right kind of customers. So this VC money flew in, went into Instagram so much that it has literally killed off the creativity of a lot of creators who had the potential to go to YouTube. Like you and I, we had no option. Like even I, for that matter, had an option to go with Instagram Reels. But you know what? We took the tough call. I don't know what we were thinking, but we took the tough call of giving away YouTube, giving up on Instagram Reels. And we said, let's go completely bullish on YouTube because we are educators. We need to provide value. Value cannot be given in 60 seconds. Value needs 20 minutes. We will stick to YouTube. Let everybody else make money on Instagram. So we did not get distracted over there, because of which even today we're reaping the benefit of optimizing for value and long-term relationship with our subscribers as compared to just views, clicks, and dopamine. So this whole thing starts on the brands, and this is where I wanted to ask you, because you are so bullish both on Instagram and YouTube. Although you're more focused on YouTube, your ripple is actually showing result on Instagram as well, where you've got like, what, 2.4 million on Hindi, 4 million on English, which is crazy. So my question is, when brands approach their marketing campaign, bro, when there is such a loyal audience on YouTube, when there's a dearth of content creators, which means they're going to get the maximum visibility, why do brands even today choose to go on Instagram rather than YouTube? I know 2 years back it was all about dopamine, but does that make any business sense?
Firstly, if someone asked me the business angle on this, I would turn to you and like ask you the question, because you're one of my bros in my life who probably understands business with the most clarity that I have seen. But I can give you like a slightly more human and emotional perspective. Firstly, I feel the people who are the decision makers for the brands are who? The marketing heads, maybe the CMO. They themselves use Instagram more than YouTube. That's one massive part of it. So I think at the core, it's a human decision that chalo are uska account fat raha chalo karte. Now this is one way of answering this question. I just feel Instagram usage is a lot more. Indians are an emotional janta as compared to the West, which is much more self-improvement and dry almost. Indians are moist. So like I think a lot of India is on Instagram. That's one aspect of this. Second aspect would be the brand heads would be on Instagram. The third is, if an Instagram campaign is done right, I think it can have an impact for the brand. And I say that because of how we have marketed our own shit on like Instagram. In terms of, I have a meditation app. We see results on both YouTube and Instagram, but it depends on the nuance of how the content is done out. Are you convincing enough in your sales skills on Instagram as you are with YouTube?
And tell me about... And I know, because we had this conversation last time offline, where you spoke to me about how powerful YouTube is as compared to Instagram for brands, and how brands are not leveraging YouTube enough. Tell me about that.
Yeah. I think it takes a lot to be a YouTuber. I've played both games very intensely. It's thrice or four times as difficult to be a YouTuber because that many more skill sets are involved. The audience is smart enough to recognize that. If the audience is watching you for longer than a minute in today's day and age, that says a lot. If the audience chooses to not watch short content and then watch horizontal long form content, that says a lot. And above all, try recalling 5 or 10 reels or shorts you saw yesterday versus 1 or 2 long form videos you saw yesterday. It's just a very human thing. The recall value of remembering that is a lot more, which is the basis of marketing. Okay. I'm all for jersey sponsors in sports. For example, Manchester United just changed their jersey sponsor to Snapdragon. I'm a huge Man United fan. I went and saw what Snapdragon is now because it looked good on that jersey. And then apparently there's a narrative about jersey sponsors being irrelevant, etc. Dude, no, you will remember something if it's done well, if it's in the domain that appeals to you. There is a significant portion of the Indian population that turns to YouTube as new age television. I also believe when we were growing up, there was Nat Geo, Discovery Channel, Animal Planet. These were the three knowledge based channels. History Channel would be the fourth. I think YouTube is a substitute for TV from when we were growing up. And you remember some great television ads in the same way you will remember great influencer marketing campaigns if they're done on YouTube. You may or may not remember them if they're done on Instagram because the recall value isn't strong enough.
But just to conclude this entire discussion, tell me something. If you were a brand, and because you've built a level Supermind, we'll get deeper into it. If you were a brand, how would you approach social media campaigns? Where would you choose YouTubers? Where would you choose Instagrammers?
Very subjective conversation.
Okay.
Like every brand, for example, Harpic would be very different from McDonald's, would be very different from Level Supermind, would be very different from 1% Club.
Okay. So let's take EdTech as a category and then we'll explore two to three more categories.
EdTech, I know that the end consumer, someone who wants self-improvement. So without putting two thoughts into it, I'd put my money on YouTube.
Okay. And what would be your split? Let's say you get 10 crores in budget.
I'd put in EdTech specifically less than 10% on Instagram.
And 90% on YouTube.
You're just talking about YouTube and Instagram, right?
Yeah.
Or Twitter, LinkedIn.
No, just YouTube and Instagram.
Yeah. 90% on YouTube, 10% on Instagram. And I'd start with a small capital to begin with, do my A-B testing, and then adjust that 90 and 10 into a 95 and 5 or an 85 and 50.
And how would you choose a particular creator to collaborate with as a brand? What would be your criteria?
Try understanding who the audience of that particular creator is, but with the basis of views and engagement. And the engagement can be seen in the comment section. Nowadays, you can buy computer-generated comments, bot comments. So I'd also scan the comment section a bit to understand whether these are genuine comments, are these genuine human beings or not. And another gauge, especially when it comes to top creators, is try seeing whose name gets brought up in your day-to-day conversations with people who are not from the media world. Interesting. That's a very strong content creator. And you want to work with content creators on the rise. So if someone's name gets brought up, hey, did you see this girl's page? Did you see this guy's YouTube channel? Those are the creators you want to work with. So I'd actually go very creator first and quantity second when it comes to influencer marketing campaigns, which is what in my eyes is the role of an agency. That if a brand is coming to you with a certain packet of money and saying, hey, take my money, do whatever you want, give it to the agency and let the agency tailor make such a strong campaign for you based on your end results in mind, that you as a brand don't need to look into it. That is the job of an agency in my eyes.
Which, and most of the agencies don't do well.
Don't do. But the ones that survive, do it. Yeah. The ones that are constantly growing, do it. And this is a matter of them telling the brand, hey, you know, your idea may not be the best, but let me give you another idea.
So this also brings about the moat of an agency. The moat of an agency is when an agency acts less as an intermediator and more as a consultant, as a guide to the brands to run their campaigns. Is that correct? And secondly, what you're saying is when it comes to an EdTech brand, if I were to summarize what you just mentioned, A, it would be a 90-10 split to start with. And then based on the learning, it would be 85-15 or 95-5. And there, once it comes to YouTube, while you choose your YouTubers, you would choose YouTubers who often come up in the conversations with people who are not of your industry, A. B, you would have a look at the comment section versus the engagement, because engagement could be bought, but comments could not be bought to a large extent, and bot comments are very evident. And three, you would play the quality game versus the quantity game, which is collaborate with only few creators who truly bring credibility to the brand as compared to too many creators just spreading out the word.
Yeah. So also try not working with overlapping creators for one single campaign. I think then you're wasting your money as a brand.
And what exactly would you check in the comment section? Like, what are the 3-4 questions that you ask your team to scan through the comment section to find out what is the sentiment for that creator?
I'm talking about just YouTube here. Okay? Yeah. Instagram comments are a little more loose and chilled out.
Yeah.
But if someone is willing to take their time and watch a long form piece and then take further time and think and comment, that means the content creator has made it to that person's heart for the right or wrong reasons.
Oh, wow.
So if there's a positive comment and there's a lot of positive comments, it probably means that creator is doing something very, very, very right. That's the equivalent of a batsman scoring a century.
That is such an interesting way to look at things, bro. Whereas I have always seen comments as mere engagement. But what you're saying makes a lot of sense, because if there are, let's say, 10,000 comments below a video that has got like 100K views, that speaks volumes, because 10% of them are comments. So the numbers are great. And when those comments, in fact, this is what reminds me of my dear friend Ansh Mehra, who is a very small creator,
No, okay. UI UX.
UI UX.
Very intelligent guy. Yeah.
Doesn't get a lot of views, but the kind of effort that he puts in, you know, he gets handwritten letters from his subscribers saying that, oh, you know what, Ansh, this changed my life.
I would work with Ansh Mehra on a lot of shit. Like, if I was fully in charge of an agency and I'm not operationally involved on Monk Entertainment anymore, very consciously, in order to focus on my content creation career. But if all those brand budgets came to me, almost for like every brand campaign, I would go to Ansh Mehra, keeping his audience in mind.
Yeah, and he's a legend, bro, in terms of, because I know the kind of work that he puts into every single aspect of his video. And he often says ki bachcha ye dekhega, bachche isko aise dekhenge, bachche isme se ye leke jayenge. Koi bachcha agar ye dekh raha hai, to even while explaining to his editors, he's like, koi bachcha agar ye dekh raha hai, to usko ye nahi samajh mein aayega. Dude, like, and he gets what, 10,000 views, 20,000 views? And I often tend to ask him that, why are you micro managing these tasks which will not give you a lot of returns, okay? And when I say returns, I mean the color scheme. He's like, it has to be slightly darker, 10% darker. I said, you know, bro, even I'm obsessed with these kind of things. Even I think about how students take screenshots and take notes, but this is a little too much. Don't think too much over here. And he's saying that agar koi bachcha ek entry level phone ke through agar mera video dekh raha hai, to unke screens mein iska jo brightness hai, ye thoda upar niche ho jayega, jiski wajah se I'm using this color. Bro, I was like mind blown and fascinated by the kind of effort that this guy is putting in, not for the numbers, but for the students. And that effort literally shows in, like you mentioned in the comment section, where students are like showering so much love about how it has changed his life, about how it has given their parents more hope because of what they've learned. And there was also a LinkedIn post recently which said that, oh, you know what, guys, courses cannot give you returns, but Ansh Mehra is this one strange creator who's putting it all for free, and that is the reason why I hate Ansh Mehra. Because and in fact I think the post started with I hate Ansh Mehra, and I was like, dude, who's hating on Ansh? And he's like, dude, he's doing so much work for you guys that I hate him because he did not exist while I was studying what you guys are studying right now. So that speaks volumes, and this is something that you brought up, which says that when it comes to comment section, it's not just a reflection of the engagement, but it's a reflection of how much the creator has touched the heart of the viewer. And how would you optimize for conversion, bro?
Like, for
because
the brand,
brands often say, oh, you know what, we're not getting clicks and...
The brand should have a lot of clarity on why they're doing the campaign. Are they doing it for clicks? Are they doing it for sales? Are they doing it for quote-unquote branding?
Do you think conversions could happen through just one campaign?
Yes. I've seen that on Level.
Okay.
Again, that's a sales game. And
bro, I would consider Level to be an exception because Level has you. Okay. Today, Level Supermind is known to everybody. But had you been like Headspace without any distribution, but with a lot of funding, I don't think Level would be where it is today. Especially because you have this innate characteristic of meditation. You fall into the exact brand persona. Plus, you're good at amplification. Plus, you've got the machine gun strategy. So, I don't think Level will be a comparison.
One angle on Level is right now. So, we keep a Level Supermind link under every video.
Yeah, I've
video.
Seen that.
But we constitute only 30% of the traffic that Level Supermind receives.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay.
Which is a great sign for us.
Yeah. And where does the rest of the 70% come from?
Performance marketing, as well as their own distribution pages, as well as word of mouth at this point.
So with the first campaign, how would you optimize for conversion?
You're talking about Level?
No.
Any
general
brand. I truly believe that the... Have you seen Dragon Ball Z?
Yeah.
You know how there's Super Saiyan 3, which is the final form of Goku. So the final form of any salesperson is content creation. I think content creators inherently are God-gifted when it comes to sales. Leave it to the content creator. With clarity, either the brands or the agencies have to communicate with the content creator and tell them, hey, we want to generate sales. Hey, we want to generate traffic. Hey, we want to generate XYZ. If the content creator is one of the top people, they'll be able to do whatever the brand wants. Because they understand their own community the best. There's no way Ganesh understands Ranveer's community, and there's no way Ranveer understands Ganesh's community, because you have a certain one-to-one relationship. Maybe only the other person who understands Ganesh's community is whoever's helping you on the videos the closest.
Yeah.
Like in my case, Akshat, who's my lead creative probably understands it better than Nachiket, who's the lead business guy. And Nachiket also obviously has an understanding. But my point of saying that is only the people who are... See, what is our interaction with the customer? It's through that video interface.
Correct.
That is the upper layer of our organization going out, front end going out to these people. So you're communicating with them once a week, sometimes much more than that. You know exactly where the audience is at. Due to you being a content creator, often you know where society is at. So let the brand put you fully in charge of the campaign and then use basic sales skills. I'll take that. And then use basic sales skills after a point. Basic sales skills entail confidence, entail actually like having a good product. So I mean, that's also an angle. Like you should be able to choose a good product as a creator. A story and creating a need within the customer for that particular product. So while they have trust in you, am I able to create a need within Ganesh where I say, hey man, look at how nice this sweater looks. Have you ever tried wearing like this color? Oh, okay. You've not? Cool. But you know what? When I've worn this color, like this is when I get like the most compliments. And then suddenly you're like, oh, but maybe I don't want the t-shirt. I don't want the sweater, but I want the compliments. Let me just try it. I'll purchase it.
Interesting. So you're saying, you're actually saying the complete opposite of what most brands do, which is they try to micromanage creators and they end up doing a bad job. You know, bro, Odoo is one such brand that we've been working with. Okay. Bro, you know what Odoo does? Odoo says that this is our feature. We just want to bring in visibility for this feature. Give us whatever video you think is best. Same is the case with Growth School also. And that's because Weibo is a friend, not because he's a brand. Same thing, bro. This is Growth School. We have this course. Whichever video you think will get us maximum visibility, please give us that and we are okay with it. Bro, every time a brand says something like this, we operate with minimum pressure, but we eventually end up generating maximum output.
Yeah.
As compared to a brand which is extremely picky and choosy.
The thing is, I've been trying to put out this message since 2017 when we founded Monkey. And it's not gone through yet. The brand world is determined by traditional masters in business administration grads.
True. Who have never created a piece of content.
Who think in a certain way because textbooks tell them to think in a certain way, and that's fine. But they will stick to the textbooks over what a 25-year-old creator is telling them. And you can't blame them. It's just how the world works.
And this is the reason why, you know, we often refrain from working with a particular brand because they just become too picky. You know, when it comes to us, we have now reached a point where we just tell no to most brands because they just become too picky. Not because a brand doesn't have a good product, but because they just get too picky. And we tell them that, guys, this will not work out because what I care about is my team's morale. If my team's morale goes down because the brand is being too picky, I don't need the money. But at the same time, the brands who are extremely liberal, my team is having fun making the video for them. They are having fun getting the results and we are able to upload on time. Sometimes what happens is that there have been a few brands that we've worked with. They push the upload date again and again and again because they're making one or two changes, bro. They say instead of sign up, say click the link. I said, how the hell is that going to make any difference? You think it's going to make a difference, but it is not.
You know, sometimes these kind of micro changes, some of them make sense to me. But very often it's a case of someone trying to feel important because they're feeling insecure within the corporate structure. So I've noticed that if I ever sense that, and it happens, you go and have a conversation with that person, express a sense of empathy and say, hey, I get where you're coming from, but this is like what I think would do well. And at the end of the day, you and me on the same team. I'm your striker, you're my midfielder. Let's win the match.
Bro, tell me something. Now that we've understood EdTech, let's change this category to FinTech now. If you were a FinTech brand and you worked with a lot of FinTech companies as well, if you were a FinTech brand, how would you approach influencer marketing?
Okay, firstly, I want to begin by saying that out of all the domains I possibly know, finance-related stuff is where I'm mostly an amateur.
Okay.
Okay, even when it comes to my own money, I have very good people handling my money for me. And it's always been something I'm not naturally inclined towards. But I'll have a shot at it. FinTech also, it can, according to me, it's either thode advanced level FinTech products which are targeted at someone who understands finance and someone who doesn't understand finance is the other category, broadly speaking. So if it's the more casual financial person, So if it's the more casual customer you're speaking about, then I would have a 30-70 split, where 30% would go towards Instagram. And if it was the most serious one, again, I would do 90-10.
And most brands are up for the serious audience, right?
And we're talking about YouTube versus Instagram. So 90 for YouTube, 10 for Insta for the serious fintech. And if it's a casual, friendly kind of fintech thing, then 70 on YouTube and 30 on.
So you're saying it depends on the customer persona?
Yes.
Or the brand persona?
Both.
Interesting. And when it comes to YouTube, why would you go completely bullish on YouTube for a serious fintech brand?
Bro, I would go bullish on YouTube for any influencer marketing thing. Yeah. I can't think of a brand that I wouldn't market on YouTube, firstly.
But why do you think YouTube creators command such a high premium when it comes to brand deals as well as audience loyalty? Is it simply because of the content that they put out?
New age television.
Because I think one more factor that often comes in is the accuracy of YouTube distribution. Because I don't understand Instagram distribution that much. But as much as I understand YouTube, a brand once asked me, what kind of content should we produce to hit this target audience? I said, you don't have to hit that particular target audience. You just have to make content that is relevant for that particular audience. And YouTube will get that audience to that particular content, eventually making it a hit. So it's not you who's targeting the audience. It's YouTube that is targeting. You just assume that YouTube is the best marketer you ever have. And because it is enabled with software and AI, it's going to get you the best of the results. And that's what usually happens. And, you know, what I've often seen is that when we produce geopolitical content, our geopolitical audience is far different as compared to an audience that consumes business content. And it's quite fascinating because when I meet people at the airport and I ask them about what is your favorite piece of content, they often tell me that, oh, you know what, we watch all of your business case studies. And when I ask them about geopolitics, they didn't even know that I produced geopolitical content, bro, which is pretty strange.
The algorithm takes it there.
Yeah, I mean, there is such a beautiful, I would say, bifurcation of the audience also, which is strictly business, an amalgamation of both business and geopolitics. Then there is economics. Then there is CA audience, which specifically gets only economics-related videos, which is so strange and so interesting as well, because now the brand can actually choose which subset of the audience that the brand wants to target for that particular creator, provided the brand understands that a creator has multiple subsets of audience. And then when you talk to the creator, you understand which subset you want to target. And accordingly, if the creator can choose the video which can get you the right TG and reach, that's when the brand gets a great return. So when it comes to something like, let's say, a lifestyle brand, let's take Mokobara for example. Now, if I were to understand this from the outset, to me, Mokobara is a lifestyle product.
Or they make bags, right?
They make bags, travel bags. So if I were to market Mokobara, the easiest way, and I think the most convenient and perhaps the most obvious way that comes to my mind, is you just go bullish completely on Instagram, where you get creators to post stories, you get creators to use the bag, you give them bags for free. And once people see it, once people spot it at the airport, eventually it will gain traction. Do you think over here also YouTubers have an important role to play?
I'd reduce that ratio to about 60-40 or 50.
Oh, so you're saying that, so from what I can make out of this, let's take one more example for that matter, just to understand this better. What about a perfume brand?
Same. I put perfume in that same lifestyle category.
Okay. So when it comes to lifestyle products, you think Instagram will always do well as compared to YouTube?
Again, because Instagram is being used from a place of emotion and time pass rather than self-improvement. I do not put lifestyle products into self-improvement necessarily, because you only approach lifestyle products from a self-improvement perspective once you've made money. And you're trying to upgrade, like, oh, I want to wear a more branded shoe, I want to wear a more branded perfume, etc. I personally believe that even rich people want to have a time pass phase. So the rich, lots of rich people use Instagram. In fact, I think that the richest of the rich, I've not seen them using YouTube, but I've seen them using Instagram. Twitter, yes.
Okay.
But everyone wants to have fun. So you reach out to all sorts of audiences on Instagram first and foremost. It's that upper middle class and getting rich, still motivated to learn. They use a lot of YouTube, which also answers the question about why we do Yetis and all that. Because, for example, bro, I consciously, if I'm opening YouTube myself and I earn fairly well for my age, my intention is to never learn off of YouTube, but it's to just explore the topics I have fun with. And my feed is mostly sports, okay, maybe like 80% sports and 20% history.
Bro, now tell me something. You mentioned about the long game. You mentioned about building trust. You mentioned about, you know, so many nuances of the kind of audience that exist in this country. But in spite of knowing a large chunk of it, a lot of creators begin their journey on, let's say, Instagram. Some people even make it to YouTube. They make it very big on YouTube. But the first generation of creators that existed back then, who are the big shots of YouTube, today most of them are not that relevant. So what do you think are the most important reasons why creators have gone irrelevant? And in the next 5 years, what are the reasons why a creator would go irrelevant? Let's start with the first question as to why have the OGs of YouTube and the content world gone irrelevant in the past 5 years?
Life, bro. Okay, I was kidding, but that's the actual answer. I think people's priorities change, okay. First and foremost. They're done with the fame game. Some of them are done with the money game. Okay. Not everyone wants to be relevant. That's a big core aspect of this. Staying relevant is like pouring fuel into a fire. Where's that fuel coming from? Are you motivated to be pouring it? Are you motivated to be harvesting the fuel from somewhere? For example, like the reason I have stayed is because my goals are big materially. I don't feel I'm done yet. Someone may be done materially. Someone might lose the material ambition. Someone else probably began the game for the sake of fame, and they've reached a certain level of fame where their thirst for fame is quenched. So honestly, I feel on a very, very core level, it's life. It's not that they probably were okay with losing their relevance.
But that's one part of it, bro. That is people who are content.
You're saying people who lost their relevance despite wanting.
Correct.
Lack of reinvention and lack of building teams.
Let's talk about reinvention. When it's something like infotainment or humor, how would you reinvent yourself?
Okay, I'll just take those two. Okay? Humor, I'd reinvent myself by going into feature films or by writing a series. I think that's the steady progression for an entertainment-based creator.
Like Vipul Goyal wrote Humorously Yours.
Yeah. I think there's also sustainable money in that if you're willing to treat that as a professional career. Like, I think some of these Orange Juice gang, they're going to be media legends in 20 years, 30 years time, because I see them at play, very hardworking, very consistent with their content releases. But at the same time, they're not satisfied, huge thirst to be quenched, and very, very naturally gifted at writing and direction. So I feel like all these guys, Saurabh Ghadge, Focused Indian, to name two of all of them are going to do well. Very hungry for growth, reinventing. They have all the right signs.
So you're saying that it's not about reinventing yourself on social media, but it is about reinventing the products that you produce themselves.
Yes. In my eyes, Karan Johar is a content creator.
Karan Johar is an OG content creator, bro. And I did not realize it until Tanmay Bhat spoke about Karan Johar. And that's when he spoke about relevance. He was like, dude, Karan Johar has been relevant for what, 3 decades now? 3 decades? How can you stay relevant for 3 decades when superstars of that age found it difficult to stay relevant even for 1 decade? That it is just massive. And today, because you see the likes of Amitabh Bachchan and you think, oh, you know what, staying relevant for 5 decades is a normal thing, but it is extraordinary. And how many people of the league of Amitabh Bachchan and even beyond him have stayed relevant till now or for 4 decades?
It's a human caliber, but there's also a trade-off.
What is that trade-off?
Time, human relationships, mental health, contentment, spiritual growth, experiences. So much, I can go on, bro. Like, there's a price you pay.
And when it comes to Instagram or YouTube, now that we're speaking about irrelevance, I believe it is much easier to go irrelevant on Instagram as compared to YouTube. Do you think that's right?
Yes.
Why so?
Fast fame can often go away fast as well. Like, if the fame has taken time to build up, it stays for that much longer, in short. But also with Instagram, it's a matter of an excess of content creators. You're cool today, you won't be cool tomorrow unless you reinvent.
And so do you see, and in fact it is, I think one of the biggest barriers to entry for YouTube is also the difficulty of the content. Difficulty of producing a 20-minute content versus producing a 90-second content.
A 20-minute content piece that people will watch. I think that retention angle is also that's a much bigger challenge. Sorry, repeat the question you're saying.
I said making a 20-minute video is far difficult as compared to making a 90-second video, which is why it is easier for people to remain on Instagram and be satisfied with the kind of money that they're making versus doing it on YouTube. Because if you look at the effort is to reward ratio.
Yes, correct.
On Instagram, it takes one day to produce a reel. It gets you a million views. Whereas on YouTube, for the first 50, 60 videos, you won't get any views at all. So when you look at the effort is to reward ratio, creators often tend to think that to produce a 20-minute video, it took me 3 days and a lot of production budget. Whereas when it comes to the same production budget with the same amount of time, they could produce 10 odd reels and they could get 10x more following, which could make them 10x more money. So the equation of YouTube versus Instagram will never really come to terms unless you start from negative and then go to positive on YouTube. Whereas with Instagram, it's always positive and it will keep on going positive. But the point is, it will come crashing down very quickly.
In retrospect, so one thing I did correctly, but it was very, very, very difficult and brutal on so many levels, was to parallelly grow YouTube and Instagram. I do believe that in the modern day, you need to choose one of the games, and 99.9% people would choose Instagram.
Yeah.
Because it's just much greater reward for much lesser effort. Also, I feel in the modern day, if someone starts content creation at this point, Instagram is a fantastic training ground for YouTube. But the good news about the training ground is that it'll pay you well. So are you ready to train and get paid, or actually use that training to go into war and go win a kingdom? But again, it's too much effort, bro. Parallelly with YouTube, I don't think YouTubers are as celebrated, you know, as they used to be. So there is that cosmetic change that's happened in content creation culture as well. Also, to a large degree, bro, and I bring up your name as an exception to this rule very often. I think that YouTubing has become podcasting. There's just podcasts on YouTube, and I'm running TRS. But I sincerely hope that this is just a phase and we go back to seeing a YouTube where there's a much greater variety of content. So personally, like, I'm trying to get into content that's inspired by Think School and Dhruv Rathi and Abhiyan New, like the kind of content you guys make where it's talking to camera. Y'all are a very good version of what YouTube used to be in terms of infotainment, and we don't see that anymore. So at some point, like, I want to go back into that style of content. And my personal, the subjects I love are sports, history and spirituality. I don't know if I'll like explore sports, but at least history and spirituality one can. Pretty much what we're doing on Raas, it's history and spirituality without Ranveer's face being there. So that's its own team which has been groomed and all that. And at some point I'll want to go back into that content, you know. Like, I love podcasting because it's a very rewarding job on 100 levels, be it your sense of self, be it your networking, be it money, numbers, etc. But I truly miss, like, just YouTubing, you know, vlogging, motivational videos. I miss so much. Bro, I still like make such stunningly aesthetic motivational videos. Like, there's a filmmaker inside me, you know. I would personally, at some point, there is this creative dream of wanting to direct a film as well, but that part of me would get very satiated through creating motivational videos. And those videos still get views, even if our fitness videos don't. The views are still clocking up on those.
Bro, I still remember when you went to take that award from the Prime Minister, you did this. And that was too good, bro. Because after that, I was wondering, why did you do this? And then I realized it's such an iconic gesture that it first of all stood out. Secondly, I think after a few days, one of your editors actually put out an edit in such a way that when you did this, he actually brought in Arjun. And it was a message, again, playing on the emotions. It was a very strong message. I was like, dude, like, this one gesture speaks so much. And the kind of storytelling that it was inculcated into, it was too amazing, man. And, you know, when you see all of those pieces come together, like I said, to me, you are like a big goddamn case study. So I keep studying every small elements and I try to dissect and see what you're doing right, what you're doing wrong. And I also remember I was telling Neil from iPlex that Ranveer has built such a brand persona that he's collaborating with a freaking stapler brand, bro. I don't know which brand that was. I think it was Staples or something, some random
brand. I've done rice. I have done staplers. I have done thermos flasks.
Thermos flask, I remember. That was your first quirky sponsor segment, right? And I was like, dude, what the hell is this guy doing?
I love collaborating with these brands that one wouldn't expect. I've collaborated with a tire brand. And we always create something quirky for these weird brands.
My question is, do you reach out to them or do they reach out to you?
At this point, they reach out to me, bro. It's been
but back while. Then, when you were collaborating with a tire brand or with a stapler brand, what did you do?
I mean, back then we collaborated with only fitness brands and fashion brands.
Okay.
You know, because that's directly linked to your content from back then. But at this point, it's incoming, which is why we were talking about branding some time ago, and then you were like, do you not worry about how it's perceived? At the end of the day, it's been a very conscious effort to place my name within the branding. So be it switching to Hindi content and not calling it Beer Biceps Hindi, but Ranveer Allahbadia, or be it creating an IP called The Ranveer Show, I am the brand. So, and my own evolution is the brand's evolution. So I have to just focus on not f***ing it up and like not letting my teammates down, not letting go of a reputation that's taken time to build. And that boils down to life choices. So just don't do the wrong shit in life and the brand will take care of itself.
Bro, I'm taking back so many things from this conversation. And I think we should pause this conversation because I know for a fact that this will go on for the next 3 hours. But I think we should do another episode on this. So here are my most important takeaways. Number one, do not be a creator, be an entrepreneur. Don't be the person who produces content. Be the person who produces systems and processes that then eventually go on to produce content. And when it comes to posting, be extremely consistent with your posting, at least during your initial days. Most importantly, you have to understand that you have to become the talk of the town and not just a viral trend. Because eventually, when it comes to your reputation, a lot of creators will go viral and they'll hit a million views. But the ones who actually make it to the conversations of the common people, they are the ones who are OG content creators. When it comes to brands, brands have to give creators enough leverage and enough freedom to be able to express themselves the way they want. The brands that do not do it are the ones who actually end up suffering more in spite of putting in more work, as compared to brands who don't put in any efforts into their campaign. Just tell the creator what they want, what they expect, and let the creator do the job that they do best. When it comes to YouTube versus Instagram, if it is a lifestyle brand that you are trying to promote, then Instagram is the best. If it is anything that has to do with serious audience, which pays well, which wants to upgrade itself in terms of not lifestyle, but in terms of spirituality or in terms of self-help, YouTube is the best way to go. As a creator, what I understood is that you're supposed to follow, if not machine gun strategy, some strategy. The machine gun strategy is also laid out very well, which is basically built on the foundation of great documentation, which is to be able to understand the sentiment of the audience, identify what type of content we have which can resonate with the sentiment of the audience or go against that sentiment, and then put out that content strategically on time with no delay whatsoever, but push them in volumes if you are somebody like a podcaster. That eventually resonates very well with the audience. If it is Instagram, it has to be more focused on the emotion. If it is YouTube, then it has to be more focused on the knowledge. And the same information can be put out with emotion on Instagram, but with a lot of knowledge on YouTube. And that eventually drives extraordinary relevance, which you can then use to then make other things relevant. And that's where you enter the virtuous cycle, where you try to build a media house, and that media house then makes things more relevant. So we enter a virtuous cycle where anything that you cover becomes a sensation. Anything that becomes a sensation is what you cover. And when it comes to sentiment of the audience, I also understood, and this is something that's coming from my observation, is that music also plays an important role. And for reference, I'll actually put out, if possible, the Chhatrapati Shivaji Wala reel, which is on February 19th, when it is Chhatrapati's birthday. You put out a reel on Chhatrapati Shivaji, which is coming out of a podcast that you shot probably a year back. And yet that got a million views within a few hours. I was actually observing the engagement over there. It got a million views within a few hours. And that is because of the systems and processes that you've built. Similarly, when it comes to World Cup also, you had your content ready. And by the time India won the World Cup and people were on Instagram, everybody wanted to consume that content to keep on getting that juice. And your content served as an instrument to get that juice. When it comes to spirituality, bhoot, preet and stuff like that, the logic behind that is that it's not bound by, or it's not driven by data, it is driven by the inert, it is driven by the curiosity that you have, which eventually helps you produce content at scale. It just so happens that bhoot, preet and yeti tend to do well. As a result, you tend to do it repeatedly over the due course of time. As far as relevance is concerned, it is important that a creator often reinvents what they do time and again. That may not necessarily be about content, but be about the products that they produce. Today, they could be producing videos. Tomorrow, they could be producing documentaries. A day later, they could be producing OTT products, or they could simply be writing for OTT platforms or films. A classic example being the Orange Juice Gang or Vipul Goyal, who produced Humorously Yours. And all of this put together, what I understand is that if you be a creator, you will be relevant for 2 to 3 years and you can survive on the viral trend. But if you really want to be in this for a long term, you have to become an entrepreneur and understand the products and services that you produce from the core. As far as quantity is concerned, from what I understood from all of this is that quantity is not a problem, but direction of the quantity is the biggest challenge. If you just produce content at scale, you may not benefit. But if you produce at scale, learn from it, understand the sentiment of the audience, and then optimize your scale further, which is again produce things in very huge quantity, but this time cater to a particular sentiment of the audience, it tends to do insanely well. As far as Instagram versus YouTube is concerned, you cannot have infotainment on Instagram because it's more about emotion and people just trying to chill out. So even though you are an infotainment creator, you're supposed to keep Instagram separately and you're supposed to keep YouTube separately. Just like for a brand, emotion is important on Instagram and knowledge is important on YouTube. Even you are supposed to give out knowledge on Instagram. Versus when it comes to Instagram, you're supposed to focus on your emotion. Another takeaway that I'm actually going to jot down, and this is extremely important for all the creators, is that brand persona building is when you showcase your evolution quite openly. For you, it was the motivational videos. And I literally know every phase of your life, not because I followed you, but because you tend to tell the story so repeatedly and with such strategic intervals that if a person is following your journey, they know exactly where you are, which builds resonance, and that resonance fuels relevance, and that relevance eventually helps you give better return on investment to the audience as well as the brands in terms of the conversion. In addition to that, another thing that I learned over here is brand persona building, and the more dimensions you have to this brand persona, the better range of products can you promote. For example, you have your meditation persona because of which you've got Level Supermind. You've got a creator persona through which you're fueling Monkey. You've got your podcasting persona because of which you are now able to have BeerBiceps Skillhouse. You have your video editing persona because of which now you're also able to put out a video editing course. And back then, because you had your fitness persona, you're able to promote fitness brands. Through all of this, because everybody has seen your lifestyle evolve, you're also able to promote lifestyle brands like Wow Skin Science or the Stapler brand. And because of the visibility that you're getting on Instagram and people understand you as a person, not just as yet another creator, the resonance is helping you promote even more lifestyle products, which is fueling both relevance as well as revenue. So all of this put together, what I also understood is that each one of these units have to be treated like an individual machinery. It's not like 20 random kids just trying to build something. You have a team of 60 people, 100 people in total, 60 just for BeerBiceps, who are building this machinery in such a way that they are now running 4 brands. Ranveer Allahbadia on Instagram, BeerBiceps, and BeerBiceps on Instagram. All of this put together, when they work in sync, that's when you get relevance, revenue, as well as access, which then gives you more relevance and more revenue. Does that sum up our conversation?
Yeah. I feel a little naked right now. Yes. I think 2024 and the coming 1 or 2 years is about breaking algorithms, and it's not as difficult as people think. So I mean, this might be a biased statement, and this is something I just told you off camera, but we need more podcasts that come out of this country, not just as a means to further one's content creation journey, but as a means to increase India's soft power. So I truly believe that this wave of Indian podcasting has just started right now.
One last question that I had is, and we left out this conversation multiple times, you said that I'm one of the last YouTubers. Why is that, bro?
You need a correct human trait cocktail to be a YouTuber. And I don't see that in people other than you. Even like the upcoming people. As we spoke in the conversation, the other people I'd keep in that category is again Orange Juice Gang. Why? Because again, just extreme levels of hunger for growth.
Like, if you were to point out three things that I have to always retain as attributes of creating this whole thing, what would those three attributes be?
You're saying attributes which you already have that should always be
which you think, you know, makes us different.
Clarity with deep concepts. Okay. I think that's something you do really well, and you're able to teach like head honchos of like very big organizations also a lot about sometimes their own job. These are the conversations I've had with top corporates about you. Second, your OG core team members. Like, I think that like long-term growth will always actually be much more an outcome of their growth than your own. Because they'll force you to grow. And there will be a limit to how much one can grow alone. So these two, the clarity with depth, the core content. And third is, I think there's definitely a part of you that enjoys the art of this. Like, and by art of this, I mean everything from the clothes you choose to wear to the way you'll tailor make a video, you know, to like the cutscenes you'll choose to use. Suddenly you'll keep like one news clipping in a video. All that is like these little things are art. And I feel there are a lot of algorithm merchants out there, and you can be a very, very, very big creator even whilst you're an algorithm merchant. But at some point, an algorithm merchant gets tired of being a content creator. And then there's the artists who are doing content for the sake of content. So I put you in that category. Clarity with depth, core team members, and the artistic side of things.
Thank you so much, bro. It's been a pleasure to have you over here.
Likewise,
and
man.
I just had a lot of fun shooting this, man.
Likewise,
thank you so much.
Likewise,
it was very difficult for me to stay serious all the time. Because I was just telling my teammates over here that, you know, Ranveer is coming over here. My biggest challenge is going to be not laughing. And not saying give the controversial audience, things.
Yeah, give them a trailer of the shit we speak about on a plane or on the football field. Those conversations are not the Think School Ganesh, you know. But Ganya.
I just hope that never comes out.
So soon, maybe one day.
Too good, bhai. This is the episode that I love the most because it's extremely comforting, and this is the episode that I was least prepared for, by the way. And it has turned out to be one of the lengthiest episodes.
No, I'm glad, bro. Keep teaching us how to get richer, brother.
For sure, bro. Thank you so much.
No, love you too, bro. Genuinely, don't have much more to say than what I've already told you in the past and what I said on this episode. But very few people are here to stay. Very few. Probably even count them on the palm of your hand. And you're one of them.
Thank you so much, bro.
I don't just say that on your podcast. I say that pretty publicly, behind closed doors, everywhere. There's few people. There's like yourself. There's Agastya Shah. There's Orange Juice Gang. At least out of the people I hang with and like that I've gotten to know. At least for me, what I look at as the right cocktail to be a content-oriented entrepreneur, they're in very few people.
So, thanks a lot, bro. Means the world to me.
For sure.